Today I will continue to explain the visualization practice of compassion and bodhicitta series. I have already taught 5 sessions and today I will explain the 6th session. In the first session, I taught the correct explanation of the bodhicitta of emptiness, the oral pith instructions of the great perfection, and the fallacies of the crazy wisdom. And in the second session, I explained the visualization method of initiating the programming in entering into the Dharma realm to attain Buddhahood. While in the third session, I explained the oral pith instructions in attaining the Dharmakaya Buddha of the teachings on the key of life and death. All of them have already been uploaded to the Dzogchen Buddhist Association's TV channel on YouTube, and you can watch them again. The fourth session was talking about the teachings on the key of life and death too, the oral pith instructions in attaining the Sambhogakaya Buddha, and the oral pith instructions and detail explanation of the visualization practice on Heart Sutra. And the fifth session was talking about the teachings on the key of life and death 3, the oral pith instructions in attaining the Nyingmapa Buddha, as well as a comparison on the oral pith instructions of the visualization practices between the Great Perfection and the Heart Sutra. All these have already been uploaded to the Dzogchen Buddhist Association's TV channel on YouTube. It is better for you to watch them again. And I will talk about the sixth session in this lecture. What will this lecture teach? I will make the comparisons among the oral pith instructions of the visualization practices in the daily life by the Heart Sutra, the Diamond Sutra, and the Great Perfection. It is because, at this point, we have already reached the point where we begin to talk about something related to the daily life. Well, before we start, let me briefly explain why we have to learn the visualization practice of the compassion and bodhicitta. What are the benefits and effects? In fact, if we do not have the compassion, we wouldn't be able to be reborn in the Buddha's pure land. There is also even no way for us to be reborn in the realm of heavens. Indeed, what it means is that if you do not have compassion, then you wouldn't be able to be reborn in the Buddha's pure lands, where the places would have Buddhas to explain the Buddhist holy Dharma so as to teach us how to practice. You would already not be able to even to go these places. Furthermore, even for the ordinary realm of heavens, you would also not be able to go. Why do we have this compassion? And why we have to practice compassion, such that it enables us to go there? It is because our original Dharma nature, or our original intrinsic nature, originally have compassion. But because our intrinsic nature has already gone through such numerous rebirths in the cyclic existence, or samsara, or the cycle of karmic existence, therefore, all these characteristics of us, all our crystal clarity of intrinsic awareness or rigpa, and our knowing and realizing, have, essentially, already been contaminated by these rebirths in samsara, and therefore it has been blocked out, and makes it unable to be revealed. However, since the compassion belongs to this Dharma nature, and it is a characteristic of our Dharma nature, or our original Buddha nature, therefore, if we use this compassion to practice, it would be easier for us to recover it. But since we have gone through such long period of time, therefore only a very little of it might have left that can be revealed. Let's say, our heart of pity, that is, when we see other people suffer a lot, then we really want to help them. Indeed, many people born with this kind of heart of sympathy. Hence, most of the time, it is relatively easy for us to practice this heart of pity. Next is mercy, which means giving happiness, that is, giving happiness to others. This, indeed, requires education to let sentient beings learn to share with others, such that it would be easier to let mercy reveal. This is mercy and pity. In fact, we originally possess it, but it has been blocked out, so we need to practice in order to let it reveal again. If we do not have bodhicitta, then, in fact, we would not be able to attain Buddhahood. So, what are the benefits of becoming a Buddha? That is, we are able to be liberated from the cyclic existence, so that we will never ever need to take rebirth again in the cyclic existence, and to receive this kind of sufferings. At that time, we all have the autonomy to recover our intrinsic awareness, our Buddha nature. It could enable us to recover all our great strength, and to recover that kind of bliss of the Dharma realm, which means, by then, such kind of happiness or blissfulness that we have, is the highest level, the most complete, and nothing is comparable to it. As such, we could have the eternal bliss, and we would not have to continue to bear the sufferings of the cyclic existence. Indeed, staying in the cyclic existence is very miserable. Then, what is bodhicitta? You say, if we do not have bodhicitta, then we wouldn't be able to attain Buddhahood. Actually, bodhicitta is our perfect enlightenment, but because it is quite abstruse. So this kind of realizing and knowing is a relatively deeper level of realizing and knowing, thus there are many people who don't know how to practice it. Therefore, we divide bodhicitta into the relative bodhicitta and the absolute bodhicitta for us to practice. Then, the relative bodhicitta is further divided into the bodhicitta of aspiration or aspirational bodhicitta and the bodhicitta of action or action bodhicitta. When practicing bodhicitta of aspiration, you should firstly make vows to save all sentient beings. As you have made such a great vow, so you could continue to practice this bodhicitta. While for practicing the bodhicitta of action, you should receive and hold the bodhisattva precepts, and you should also do all the behaviors of benefit both oneself and others. In fact, if you don't receive the bodhisattva precepts, then there is no way for you to recover your bodhicitta. Hence, for all the disciples of our Dzogchen Buddhist Association, when they come to take refuge, we already require them to take the bodhisattva precepts. But some people say, I don't want to receive the bodhisattva precepts, as I am scared by some people.
I have heard them said that once I have received the bodhisattva precepts, then I have to do all things that complied with the bodhisattva precepts, but I am not yet able to do so. In fact, that those people who explain the bodhisattva precepts have explained it in a wrong way. In short, it is also very hard for us to study, that is, attending school. So, if you tell someone who is just beginning to study that he or she needs to study all the way up to PhD, then, because of your words, he or she may just give up and not study at all. Hence, he or she don't even learn the basic, like ABC, and don't even know how to do the add, subtract, multiply or divide. In that way, it would create lots of difficulties in their life, and also they would become a very ignorant and stupid person. Likewise, if you don't recover your bodhicitta, then, in fact, you would not be able to be liberated from the sufferings of the cyclic existence, and such painful sufferings would accompany you forever. Therefore, if you want to recover it, then not only you have to make vows, but you also have to receive the bodhisattva precepts. After you receive it, then you begin with 0 mark, but as you keep practicing and gradually you would have the 100 marks. So, how can we say something like that? That is, when we don't even learn ABC, not even gain 1 mark, but then we say, it is because I am afraid to study the PhD in future, or I am afraid that I have to get the 100 marks in future. It is really hard for me, therefore I do not want to receive it. But this is so wrong. At time, when there are some people who want to take refuge, they ask, can I be exempted from taking the bodhisattva precepts? Is it a must for me to come here to take refuge, and then I have to take the bodhisattva precepts? I answered him, definitely. It is because, if you don't receive it, you will never ever be able to be liberated from the cyclic existence, and you will have to suffer from infinite pain forever. So, why not receive it? He said, because there are some people said that if you receive the bodhisattva precepts, then whenever someone asks you to take your head, you have to give your head, and so I am very afraid about that. In case there is a person who really asks me to take my head, then should I really give him my head? I said, this way of interpretation is totally wrong. They simply misunderstand the Buddhist holy Dharma, and thus they wrongly teach you, so it makes you scared. Even if we were encouraged by moms and dads to study the PhD in future, it doesn't mean that we should be scared first, such that we don't even go to learn ABC and study in kindergarten. In fact, if we receive the bodhisattva precepts, we could slowly complete it step by step. You can make it slowly from 0 to 100 marks. But if you don't receive it, that is, you don't even learn the basic, like ABC, then there will never ever be a chance for you to accomplish it. And you also don't have the normal ability to deal with the daily matters, and therefore you don't even know how to calculate when you go to the market to buy food. Therefore, even if we don't want to attain Buddhahood, not wanting to bear such pains in the entire process, but we also don't want to continue to take rebirth in the cyclic existence, then we still have to receive the bodhisattva precepts, such that we could receive the protection from all the Buddhas and bodhisattvas, and those Dharma protectors. Moreover, some people are misinterpreting the meaning of benefit both oneself and others. They said, it is better for us to just do those behaviors that benefiting others, but we should not do the things that benefiting oneself. Indeed, they have misinterpreted it. Because of that, you would lose your balance, such that you would also not be able to practice and attain the accomplishment. Therefore, both our bodhicitta of aspiration and bodhicitta of action must include these. So, for the next step, we should practice in accordance with the Buddhist Holy Dharma's precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom, so that it enables us to keep a balance of our nature of mind. Then, slowly, we will be able to enter a state, and this kind of state is called a state of oneness, of the emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Then, what is oneness? That the time and space that we abide now belongs to a state of trilalike or above. Oneness refers to a point, and duality refers to two points. For more than two points, it means a state that is above duality, and is called the dualistic or multiplistic states. If you have learned a bit of science, then it would be easier for you to understand what is called oneness, duality, and triality. The emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, is actually talking about a state of oneness. If you enter this state, then you could restore your complete 100% bodhicitta, and that is what we call perfect enlightenment. What is the meaning of keeping one's balance with the middle way? It means no deviation and no clinging. So, after you enter this emptiness, you are able to arouse a crystal clarity, intrinsic awareness. And this kind of crystal clarity, intrinsic awareness, is indeed our Dharma nature, or our intrinsic nature, and it is also called a kind of characteristic of Buddha nature. And that kind of ability of realizing and knowing doesn't have any deviation, so we call it perfect enlightenment. So, absolute bodhicitta is indeed equal to perfect enlightenment. Then, by the time we are going to practice it, but the fact that we have gone through such numerous births, deaths and rebirths in the cyclic existence, our bodhicitta has already been hidden, making it barely reveal, leaving just a little bit of compassion, or even nothing left at all. Such that we might just have the heart of pity. Therefore, we should slowly practice this compassion. And by practicing compassion, we will gradually restore our bodhicitta, as compassion is a kind of characteristics of bodhicitta. We should base on this kind of characteristics to practice in order to restore this bodhicitta, and the realizing and knowing of the perfect enlightenment can be restored. But if we divide it into four steps to practice, start from mercy to pity, and then to bodhicitta of aspiration and bodhicitta of action, so you practice slowly like that, then it will take you the time of 2 to 3 great asimhya kalpas to practice, and that means you will have to practice for an endless and countless times. Hence, we should practice the first step to the fourth step, together with the fifth step, that is the absolute bodhicitta, at the same time. In this way, it will be faster. But since the absolute bodhicitta is too profound for many people to understand, thus they give up practicing it, the fifth step, temporarily, but practice the first step to the fourth step in the first place. Therefore, the progress of their practice is extremely slow, and even fails. Indeed, the failure rate is really high, reaching 99.999%. As the three great asimhya kalpas is such a long time that you can't even count for it. Hence, during such long time, we would most likely violate some precepts, and then do the wrong things, but we don't know how to restore it again. Hence, we will get downfall into the hell, which makes us even more painful, such that we can't get out. So, if one just practices from the first step to the fourth step slowly, but leaves the fifth step behind, temporarily leaving it behind and not to practice it. But this is actually very irrational or very stupid, or a way that one would take as one is ignorant, not knowing what to do. Consequently, you will cause yourself into trouble, and it becomes even worse, as when you get downfall into hell, you can't get out. And that means you won't be able to practice, thus there is no way for you to attain accomplishment. As such, we should practice all together from the first step to the fifth step. But the question is, what method can be used to let us practice all together? Indeed, what is the visualization practice for the first step to the fifth step? We have already taught it in the previous 5 sessions. Lately, there is a Buddhist magazine which can be bought in Hong Kong. If you go to a convenience store in these few days, you should be able to buy it. There is an article inside this magazine mentioned that in our Tibetan Buddhism, there is a person who has been called by some peoples as the Dharma King. He talked about absolute bodhicitta, but he just used a few words to explain it. He only used a few words to explain the absolute bodhicitta, that is, a meditation that including the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight. It doesn't even have the two words of perfect enlightenment. There is nothing but just these few words. This is a very serious mistake and is misleading. Indeed, I don't like to criticize others, but if your explanation has caused some distortions of the Buddhist holy dharma, or people in the future would follow your explanation to practice so that they practice wrongly, then I have to correct it. Hence, sorry, please bear with me, I have to say. But why this is wrong? It is because if you are a dharma propagator, you should know the most basic knowledge of the Buddhist holy dharma. If someone asks you what is the absolute bodhicitta, you should know how to answer, and the answer is absolute bodhicitta is equal to perfect enlightenment. If you don't even know the answer is perfect enlightenment, but you answer other things, and then these things would lead others to do the wrong things, then this would become a serious matter. Why? It is because the meaning of perfect enlightenment, that is akhand of state of oneness, which is the oneness of the perfect enlightenment of the absolute bodhicitta. So, it is oneness. Thus, that anything belongs to the dualistic or multiplistic states is wrong. In fact, what is called the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight. Let me explain it to you. Shamatha is to stop all the deluded thoughts. Then, what is deluded thoughts? That is those thoughts that are not related to the subject or theme of your visualization practice. Those cluttered thoughts are also called deluded thoughts. So, what is visualization? Visualization means that your visualization is required to have a theme. For instance, now I am going to visualize the Buddha Amitabha to have the Buddha Amitabha appeared, or I visualize a Yidam, or I visualize the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara. I either visualize myself as the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara, or I visualize an appearance of the image of the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara to come out. And this is called visualization. The meaning of the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight, is at time when I visualize the appearance of the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara to come out, or I visualize a Yidam to come out, I should stop all the deluded thoughts, such that anything that is not related to the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara would not turn up. And I just do one thing, that is, to focus on the visualization of the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara, including Avalokiteshvara's meritorious deeds, virtue, mind, nature and appearance. So, one is stopping all the deluded thoughts, another is focusing on visualization. These two should complement with each other. The coordination of these two kinds of operations is called the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight. In fact, meditation is akhand of abiding in meditative concentration, and under this state, which, in fact, belongs to the things of the dualistic or multiplistic states. Therefore, you cannot use the word include. Why? It is because if you use the word include, then you are actually indicating that absolute bodhicitta includes the union of shamatha and vipassana, but that is definitely wrong, as this is already the things of the dualistic or multiplistic states. So, if you're explaining the Buddhist holy dharma like that, then you are indeed misleading some sentient beings. And when these sentient beings follow this to practice, then they would never be able to achieve the perfect enlightenment. Basically, they are forever walking along a wrong path, which deviates from the right path. Therefore, he must not use this word to describe the absolute bodhicitta. That is, he must not say it includes the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight, where it should not have the word include. Then, you say, how about this, I do not use the word include, I say, the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight, is a method of practice, which, eventually, would help us restoring bodhicitta and perfect enlightenment one day, then is this okay? But there should have be restricted by every big principle, and you must keep it. If you do not keep it, then you would fail. So, what is that? Within your visualization, that is, when you are visualizing, what you should visualize. You should visualize the emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. So, when you visualize, you do not visualize any form and appearance of yidam, but you only visualize emptiness. So, by using this way to carry out the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight, you would have a chance to restore bodhicitta, and that is the absolute bodhicitta. Dzogchen on lisi such anyon of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana. Penetrative insight is a method, a practice method. It neither represents the absolute bodhicitta, nor one can say that the absolute bodhicitta includes the union of shamatha and vipassana, as this is wrong. Because by doing so, you would imply that the state of oneness, of the perfect enlightenment, includes something with the state of duality. Therefore, it is wrong, so it should not be explained like that. Hence, you should understand one thing, that is, what is perfect enlightenment, and what is the state of oneness. When I explain it in a while later, I will quote the oral pith instructions of the great perfection to explain it to you on why the perfect enlightenment is the state of oneness. Indeed, within the oral pith instructions of the great perfection, it states very clearly that the perfect enlightenment is the state of oneness. So, please don't treat it as the dualistic practice, otherwise you would not be able to succeed in your practice. And I shall explain it later, explain it again in detail. Therefore, you should understand that emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, is the only practice method that can truly rebuild and restore that perfect enlightenment. Apart from this, nothing can succeed. Whatever we practice, we have to guide it into the emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Even if you use the precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom, to complement with your practice, at last you have to enter into emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Guide yourself into that state in order to enable you to recover your bodhicitta. But, why do I have to remind some people that they should know what is a Dharma king? Indeed, how can one be called as Dharma king? Being called as Dharma king, one must possess both the qualities of both teaching, study aspect, and realization, practice aspect, abilities. Then, what is teaching? Your teaching must be extremely proficient, completely and thoroughly mastered, precise and correct. Just these are not yet enough. You should also have realization. Then what is realization? That is, matching with your understanding of the Buddhist holy Dharma, you then need to put them into practice in order to prove it. Whether your understanding of the Buddhist holy Dharma is correct or not, whether you can succeed or not, and whether you can truly succeed to prove it or not. You need to have these two things to be matching with each other, that is, you need to have your teaching to go through the process of realization via practice, such that you have finally and actually entered into the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, then you would finally understand what this state really is, to be known as the state of oneness. In this way, when you teach other people to practice, you can explain the practice coherently with the teaching. In fact, if you are able to understand it thoroughly and then explain it to others, those who listen to what you have said would then have the opportunity to understand what you really want to talk about. However, if what you said is in a disorderly manner and in an incoherent fashion, and the contents are wrong with many mistakes, which shows that you cannot understand and realize it too, yet you still continue to teach other people to practice it. As a result, these people would definitely not understand what you are talking about. Hence, some people said, I have heard people who talked about a lot of the Buddhist holy Dharma in great confusion and with great incoherence. In fact, I really do not understand what he is talking about because what he said is entirely incoherent. The reason is that they do not possess both the qualities of both teaching, study aspect, and realization, practice aspect, abilities. In fact, they don't even know what they are talking about, thus how can they make others understand? Do you understand this important point? So, if you called yourself Dharma King, or you were called as Dharma King, and you also allowed others to call you like this, then you should be very careful. You must study your Dharma theories, and study them until you are very proficient with them. Then you should also do some actual practice so as to prove them. In this way, you can achieve the possession of both the qualities of both teaching, study aspect, and realization, practice aspect, abilities. Then you are good and also becalled as Dharma King. Nonetheless, if you don't care about these things, so you just go to the Buddhist college to study for a few years, or 10-something years, but you still could not understand the Buddhist holy Dharma that you have learned. Do you know that some people who have studied the Buddhist holy Dharma for their whole life or decades, but they still cannot understand it, as their thinking are all blocked? Indeed, you have to actually realize it, and then slowly develop your own intrinsic awareness, so as to enable you to realize and know all the Buddhist holy Dharma theories that you try to understand now. Then, you would truly understand its principle, and you could explain it coherently. In reality, do you know why Tibetan Buddhism is felt to be very disparaging by many people nowadays? That one of the reasons for it to be considered as disparaging is that many people who come out to spread the Buddhist holy dharma, and they call themselves as Rinpoches and consider themselves as the jewels. Indeed, Rinpoche means jewel. In fact, it is already sufficient for them to call themselves as gurus, but they call themselves as Rinpoches, as they think that the word Rinpoche is more senior than a guru. However, they do not know how to be Rinpoche, as the majority or 99.9% of these Rinpoches simply give enormous amount of empowerments. As you know that many sutras have mentioned about empowerment, even the 50 stanzas of guru devotion has mentioned Thisvi saying that when you give empowerment to others, you must have to observe that person and see if his dharma practice has reached to a certain level, such as reaching the rank or level of the 10 noble abodes. That is, the position of the 10 noble abodes as stipulated in their Ivatamsaka Sutra, then you can give empowerment to him. Otherwise, the one who gives empowerment to others, or the one who receives the empowerment, both would violate the transgression on the overstepping of the holy dharma, that is, asana of overstepping the Buddhist holy dharma. Committing this transgression of samayas will make one fall into hell. You can see that 50 stanzas of guru devotion has also made it very clear that both the one who gives the empowerment and the one who receives the empowerment are subject to the guilt of transgression on the overstepping of the holy dharma, as both have committed this sin. Unfortunately, a large amount of so-called Rinpoches, in fact, do not understand the Buddhist holy dharma, but due to the fact that many sentient beings are so superstitious, attracted by the so-called great titles, that they like to listen to the word blessing. Then, those Rinpoches also said that how good it would be after receiving the empowerment, such as you can either become a Yidam, or you can attain Buddhahood. Hence, sentient beings are lured to go and get the empowerment for blessings. Consequently, all of them would have downfall to hell. It is because the sutras have such a provision, it is stipulated in it, and so if you do not follow suit, then you would violate the precepts. So, are the Buddhas punishing you? Definitely not. The Buddhas would never punish you. However, this is the operation of the law of nature, so you are bound by a karmic force that will drag you down. And this is not a matter that is related to the Buddhas. The Buddhas just want to let you know that please do not commit these matters. By committing these acts, you are already treading on thin ice, which would implicate your possible deadly outcomes, and that is what it means, so the Buddhas are just reminding you of this great danger. However, there are a large number of people who act like that. Therefore, it induces great amount of greed, hatred and ignorance for those sentient beings, as they have gone to get the empowerments. Those Rinpoches have advertised in the newspapers inviting sentient beings to come for their empowerment ceremonies, but they would not observe whether those sentient beings have already practiced to that level or not, and they even do not know the names of those sentient beings, but then they just conferred the empowerments to those sentient beings anyway. There are large amount of such kind of behaviors being done, and thus damage the reputation on the teachings of the genuine Buddhist holy dharma that are disseminating by Tibetan Buddhism. As such, the profound teachings of the Tibetan Buddhism have been severely damaged. Hence, there was the Dzogchen scandal incident, in which the Rinpoche had sexually abused a lot of his disciples around the world, or used violence against his disciples. He has already made Buddhist teachings, more importantly Tibetan Buddhist teachings, to become so distorted and perverted. He said the authority of the guru should be the greatest, and whatever he likes to do is also correct, so when he beats you it is also correct. These actions have become a great distortion and perversion of the Buddhist holy dharma, and this has already harmed Tibetan Buddhism, which is a very dangerous phenomenon that had occurred. Now there is one more phenomenon that appears, that is, there are some people who are not proficient in the teachings of the Buddhist holy dharma, and they have explained something that is completely wrong, but for no other reason they are being called by some people as Dharma King. Those people have recognized him as Dharma King, and have accepted him as such in explaining things in erroneous ways. He is unable to explain that absolute bodhicitta is perfect enlightenment. But he only said those words, a meditation that including the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight, to be considered as the explanation of absolute bodhicitta. This is grossly misleading, and it is also a great distortion of the Buddhist holy dharma. Furthermore, it is also a great harm and damage to Tibetan Buddhism. Hence, please do excuse me for correcting this and speaking it out in the public. I really sincerely hope that those people who would spread the teachings of Tibetan Buddhism in the future will not solely perform rituals and ceremonies by just the ringing of bells and other ritual objects, and thus deceiving people by giving out many empowerments. It would be better to go back to the right and correct path by using all their understanding on the teachings of the Buddhist Holy Dharma, as well as their foundations on the sutras to explain clearly the Buddhist Holy Dharma, so that they could explain it well, explain it coherently and explain it correctly, such that they would not explain the perfect enlightenment wrongly, and refer it as something of a dualistic or multiplistic state. Then, one can say that one is a guru. In such a way, this could then be the real hope for Tibetan Buddhism. Indeed, this is the best method to prevent people from saying that Tibetan Buddhism is a spiritual cult of some sort in the future. Otherwise, if such an excellent kind of Buddhist teaching to be contaminated by those people, it will then be treated as a spiritual cult of some sort in the future by many others. I will then feel sad and sorry about this, and it will really be a great pity and waste to be really wasted. Indeed, it is not surprising that within the thousand Buddhas of the auspicious aeon of our present world era, there are only two Buddhas who will teach the teachings of Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism. Why is this so? It is because many people who would make use of Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, to do and say some wrong things in order to mislead other people. In order to prevent this, it is better for most of the Buddhas not to allow them to do so and say those wrong things again. Those Buddhas would also say, okay, you should not spoil it, be good and listen to him, the Buddha, for the correct Buddhist teachings. In fact, this Dharma practice method is very good, and it is also an excellent method for the practicing of the Holy Dharma. However, it cannot be easily taught to others who do not fit, because those sentient beings would over-exaggerate it and will cause many misunderstandings to many other sentient beings. Therefore, I have to clarify this by today, as it is really hard to have such a golden opportunity to disseminate the genuine teachings of Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, in this era of the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni Buddha, and so I do sincerely hope and pray that it will be correctly disseminated. Lay say it now, mistakes will actually lead to failures. That is, if you listen to the person who called himself a Dharma King, then you certainly think that he is the Dharma King of Tibetan Buddhism, so what he said must be supreme and correct. Then, you follow him to practice and accept his words that the method to practice absolute bodhicitta is a thunyan of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight. But this Dharma King seems do not know what is the real meaning of vipassana, penetrative insight, and also what is the real meaning of shamatha, calm abiding. Thus, he teaches you to practice by using the dualistic way to practice something which is being regarded as the state of oneness. So, he would surely fail, and he would never be able to attain accomplishment. Furthermore, what he says is the distortion of the Buddhist Holy Dharma, and such kind of distortion and abuse will make the Buddhist Holy Dharma to become corrupted and deteriorated. Hence, that is why the dissemination of the Buddhist Holy Dharma to this day has been known as the Dharma Ending Age, SKT, Sadharma Vipralopa, Tib, Dhampari Chos Rabtu Rnam Parjigpa, because it has been grossly distorted and perverted. So, if you're a propagator of the Buddhist Holy Dharma, you should know that once you have claimed yourself to be a Dharma King, and have said something wrong like that, there are many people out there who also know about the Buddhist Holy Dharma, and not just only me, who knows it. Then, they would laugh at you after they have listened to what you have said. They would simply laugh loudly and said that absolute bodhicitta is perfect enlightenment, but even for that you did not know about it, and thus you have explained it wrongly. Then, they will not only laugh at you, but they will also feel that Tibetan Buddhism has no real substance of its own, such that even those so-called Dharma kings also do not even know about the Buddhist Holy Dharma. Thus, they would explain the Buddhist Holy Dharma in such chaotic ways, such that they would distort and corrupt the Buddhist Holy Dharma. Hence, this gives others one more excuse to attack and despise Tibetan Buddhism. I feel that it is, indeed, a great pity and waste. Actually, the study and practice of Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, is a very supreme part of the whole Buddhist Holy Dharma, and so it should not be distorted and be wasted. Hence, I have to clarify on this important point by now. We have taught you from the previous first to fifth lessons that you have to divide 24 hours a day into three periods to practice visualization. In fact, these three periods have their unique nature. So, it has to be divided into three periods. As long as you can coordinate these three periods with each other and they are interoperable, there are in fact not separated but are compatible and interoperable with each other, then by practicing like this, such that, in the end, you can practice to restore your intrinsic nature. That is the Buddha nature, and we also call it as the Dharma nature. And that is our perfect enlightenment, and we also call it as the bodhicitta. So, we could restore it this way. Then you can take this opportunity to enable yourself to be liberated from the cycle of karmic existence, or samsara, and attain Buddhahood. During the last 1-5 episode, or session, we have talked about the states at waking up from sleep, emerging from meditation and during a meditative concentration, and I also said that at the time of or death when that kind of state appears. Then we could take this opportunity to practice and enter into the Dharma realm. During this state, we should immediately use the visualization method of initiating the programming in entering into the Dharma realm. You should watch this session, that is, the second session, again. While for this session, we are going to talk about, during the daily life or in dreams, that is the time of our training in the three realms, how can we restore our bodhicitta through some actual practice, and what is the program. It takes a few sessions to teach, so I shall continue to teach you these in the following few sessions. These visualization method from the first to fifth step must be practiced all at once. If you only practice from the first step to the fourth step, but missing the fifth step, then this will be a serious trouble. Since the fifth step is the most direct and the fastest method to help you, therefore you should practice all together from the first step to the fifth step. We have already gone through sessions 1-5, talked about how to do the visualization practice during the states at waking up from sleep, emerging from meditation, and during a session of meditative concentration. Then, for this visualization practice, how can it be transformed into the visualization practice in daily life or in dreams? And what are the common points of the interoperable and compatible of these two states? This is what we are going to talk about today. Last time, we spoke about the teaching on the key of life and death, and said that in our Tibetan Buddhism, it divides all the states of existence of our life into six periods. The names of these six periods are called bardo, or the intermediate state, that is a kind of transitional period. From session 1 to session 5, we have already taught about three states. They are the bardo of dying, the bardo of dharmata, and the bardo of becoming. In fact, all these three periods are talking about those states that would appear after we died. Therefore, death itself is a profound knowledge. After death, there will have a lot of states appear, but if you can't grasp them, then you will miss a lot of opportunities, so this one is very important. Therefore, you should remember to watch our videos on YouTube again. They are the first to fifth session of the Visualization Practice of Compassion and Bodhicitta series. Well, you are able to understand that there are different states of life of existence for the six periods, but three out of these six states are talking about death, so you can imagine how important it is. However, people of the exoteric Buddhism, or Sutrayana, are not familiar with it, they really do not know it. It is because these are the profound teaching within the Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism. But for the exoteric Buddhism's teaching, they are something that you can casually talk about, like some teachings, some principles, which are superficial principles. So, they have never learnt these and therefore they don't know these. Since they do not know these, therefore they say these are useless. Then, they quoted a sentence from Confucius, "While you do not know about life, how do you know about death?" This is indeed a wrong guidance. Confucius did not understand Buddhist holy Dharma, but he was a saint. So, what he said is a philosophy. However, since you have limited knowledge at that time, you do not know the word death is really that important, as well as the fact that the world after death turns out to have so many operations that you do not know. Therefore, you say, well, we only need to know life. And that is enough, that is, to know the state of existence of life, and how to make good in your own life, and that is enough. What happen after that, that is, what happen after death, we don't care. Confucius would say something like that. But if you are a Dharma master who understands the Buddhist holy Dharma, then you should not say something like that. While you have limitations in your knowledge, meaning that you have ignorance in certain aspect, but then you should not do this, that is, to quote words spoken by a saint. It is because he didn't know about the Buddhist holy Dharma, but you know about the Buddhist holy Dharma. That is different. However, you have still quoted it in a one-sided generalization, so you're actually asking others not to learn, or not to know what will happen after death. As such, how can they continue to practice? You have seriously violated the precepts if you lead sentient beings in this way, and why? Because of your own ignorance, you then use your own ignorance to exaggerate and teach other sentient beings to become more ignorant as well. Hence, you actually deprive them of their wisdom, and deprive them of what they need to know about after death, that is, how they can use it to assist themselves to attain Buddhahood, or the wisdom to help them to get out of this danger. This kind of deprivation is cruel. You must not do this to deprive others of their wisdom for the benefit of a certain sect or school, to protect a certain sect. Therefore, you should not quote this sentence by Confucius. On the contrary, Zhuangzi, or Zhuangzi, said, "What has made one's life a good one will also make one's death a good one too." This sentence is much closer to the Buddhist Holy Dharma, and it is also similar to the wisdom of the Buddhist Holy Dharma. Some people explain like this: if we are very pleased with our lives, we should be very pleased with our deaths. However, if you explain it more deeply, it should be interpreted as such: if we are good at mastering or understanding our present lives, we will also be good at mastering or understanding our future deaths. This explanation is much closer. Therefore, we said that these three periods after death are extremely important. I even use the Heart Sutra to match it so as to explain what the state of there are neither wisdom nor attainment is all about. It is because the state appearing in the bardo of Dharmatara is the state from which we continue to evolve, entering into a cyclic of karmic existence and taking rebirth. And inside the stage of bardo of Dharmata, there would appear a state where wisdom arises. Then, let me tell you, if you want to enter into the Dharma realm, and you would like to attain Buddhahood, then you have to follow the statement, there are neither wisdom nor attainment, of the Heart Sutra to practice, such that you cut off from there. And this is a very important teaching. However, there are many people who still attack it, and they quote what Confucius said: while you do not know about life, how do you know about death, to attack it. I think we should quote what Zhuangzi had said: we cannot discuss ice with insects who only survive in the summer, to explain it. That is, since he does not know this thing, the before even he told him this thing, he still does not understand it at all. In fact, it is alright if you didn't know it, but you should not tell others not to learn, because you would then deprive others of their wisdom, and this would seriously violate the precepts. So, you have to remember that not only knowing about life but also knowing about death, so as to conform to the Tathagata, the one who perfectly knows it all, in a concrete manner. Then, what is called the Tathagata? It is the one who knows perfectly, absolutely correct and with no deviation, and he knows everything. It is a kind of realizing and knowing that knows and understands everything. Indeed, this kind of awakening on the realizing and knowing of everything is called the Tathagata. Hence, we should be not only knowing about life but also knowing about death, and you cannot say, I do not need Tathagata, I only need to know half of it and that is enough, so I only need to know about life but not about death. But this is not good at all, so, why do I need to divide it into six periods? Why our state of existence is divided into six periods? It is because we have to find the right remedy for the cause of the issue. Essentially, these six kinds of periods have different operational states. Put it in this way, we need to focus on different operational states to practice by using the right remedy for different states, such that it would be easier for us to succeed in our Dharma practice. And, what are we going to say now? That is the bardo of this life. In our daily life, how do we practice the visualization practice of compassion and bodhicitta? This is what we are going to talk about today. We have divided these into three states: waking up from sleep, or emerging from meditative state, or during a session of meditative concentration, or state we see after death, and the state of a certain period of time after death. All these moments are the moments that we could formally enter into the Dharma realm. So, what is Dharma realm? The Dharma realm is a state of existence of the state of oneness. What does it operate under? It operates under the rule of non-attainment, which is similar to what the Heart Sutra says, that is, nothing to be attained, so you get or attain nothing there. Why? It is because there is only one point. If you want to initiate the programming in entering into the Dharma realm, you should maintain that kind of realizing and knowing of the bodhicitta of the Dharma realm, as one. It is a program that I have already taught in the first to fifth lessons. One of the key points being mentioned is that we need to be all-pervasive, that is, you must be in the state of oneness in order to do so. The state of oneness is just having one point, and one point is able to be all-pervasive throughout the whole universe as a single point. It is also one point which is all-pervasive throughout the Dharma realm. So one point is all-pervasive. On the other hand, the dualistic or multiplistic states refer to two points. For example, there are two points in the dualistic state. Once two points exist, and if you connect to it, that is, one point has to be connected to another point to form a line, then you will confine your realizing and knowing to that line. If there are three points, the world that I am existing now is in the state of trilalich world, that is, with three points. Essentially, three points can form a space, and so if you connect these three points, your realizing and knowing will be confined into a state of a three-point trilalich world. Then, you would never ever be able to restore your perfect enlightenment. So, you must have to restore back to the state of oneness, that means all in one point, in order that you can be all-pervasive. Therefore, this is saying that if we want to formally enter into the Dharma realm, please remember to initiate the programming that we have taught you. One of the important points is that you have to visualize all-pervasive, that is, you have to restore all to become oneness with one single point only, and please do not make any other connections. If you connect to anywhere else, you would go wrong. So, are these things mentioned in some of the sutras? Of course, there is such a case. The Diamond Sutra has mentioned about this. I will talk about the Diamond Sutra later on. So, when we initiate the programming, or when we enter into the Dharma realm, then which programming should we initiate? Also, we are required to be trained in our daily lives and in dreams, and we must have the training and the accumulation of merits in the three realms for our practice. And what would that state be? That is the dualistic or multiplistic states. Indeed, the three realms refers to the dualistic or multiplistic states. So what law does it operate under? It is under the law of causes and effects. So you have to make it very clear as to when to operate under the law of non-attainment. When is oneness? And when is under the dualistic state? When is operating under the law of causes and effects? You must have to make it very clear on these very points. If you do not make it clear, you will end up like those cases recorded in the history that some people had practiced in such ways that had made them insane. So I must teach you how to recognize these things. Then, how should we practice? We must use the precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom, without deviation and clinging, so as to practice the visualization on compassion and bodhicitta, in order to restore the bodhicitta. And this is the precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom, that I have mentioned. Later, I will explain it in depth on why using the precept, meditative concentration and wisdom, can help you. Thus, this stage belongs to the stage of practice. Then, what should we do when we fall asleep or enter the meditative state? Actually, it is a preparation only. It is the time for preparing oneself to enter into the Dharma realm, but in fact at this stage, it still belongs to the dualistic or multiplistic states. So what does it operate under? It is under the law of causes and effects. So, at that time, when you fall asleep or enter into the meditative state, but you have to input some preparatory programs. That is why we have to input the preparatory program in entering into the Dharma realm. We call it preparatory program. What do you need to do? You have to maintain yourself in an optimal state in which you have to practice to the best possible state on compassion and bodhicitta. So, during this period, what should we apply? It should be maintaining. One is called initiating, one is called practicing, and the other one is called maintaining. So, due to the different characteristics of these three different phases, therefore, the preparation works that we have todo is different, since there are 24 hours a day. This is why we have to divide it into three stages to practice. What we are talking now is the time when we will formally enter into the Dharma realm. So when will it appear? There is a chance for it to appear at a time when we are waking up from sleep. Besides, it would also appear at a certain state when we are emerging from meditation or during a meditative concentration, and it would also appear when we are transferring from one state to another state. And there is one more, that is, after we die, there will be a period of time that it would also appear. But what does it mean if it appears at that time? It means that, at that time, all our greed, hatred and ignorance would be completely extinguished. All our greed, hatred and ignorance, and those deluded thoughts would suddenly disappear automatically. Our bodhicitta, or our perfect enlightenment, would manifest at the same time. Therefore, we must grasp onto this opportunity to enter into that state. So, we have to visualize our own compassion, our perfect enlightenment, to be filled with heart of pity. and to integrate with the bodhicitta of all Buddhas to become oneness, so as to enable the perfect enlightenment of all Buddhas to help us to restore our own perfect enlightenment again. There are also some visualization methods, but since they cannot be revealed to the public, and you also have not taken refuge yet, so how can I teach you? That means you have to take refuge to a guru, or you have taken refuge to us, then we will teach you those visualization methods. So, what are you going to do next? Please note that we have to omit parts of the visualization here. So, what is mentioning here is that you have to dissolve all sentient beings' sufferings. Next, you have to visualize your own perfect enlightenment, filled with heart of mercy. But in the middle of here, some things have also been omitted and not being taught. Then, you have to merge into the endless bliss of the Dharma realm, together with all sentient beings, that is to restore the perfect enlightenment again before you could enter into the Dharma realm. You could then recover the bliss of the Dharma realm, also known as the bliss of Dharmata, which is the highest level of happiness. Then we have to continue visualizing this kind of realizing and knowing of the perfect enlightenment is all pervasive. It belongs to a kind of intrinsic awareness, rigpa, of the perfect enlightenment, that is, we have to make that very point to be all-pervasive. Then, how can we transit to the next stage, that is, wet practice like this, which I have already taught you the program to practice, but how can we make a transit to our daily life? We must add one more visualization, that is, we have to visualize that because we want to save all sentient beings, and so we should arouse the aspirational bodhicitta, bodhicitta of aspiration. But don't we have another one called the relative bodhicitta? In fact, the relative bodhicitta is divided into two parts. One is called the aspirational bodhicitta, and the other is called the action bodhicitta. Bodhicitta of action, the aspirational bodhicitta, is that you should make a vow to save all sentient beings. Therefore, originally, you are in the state of oneness when you are in the state of waking up from sleep, or emerging from meditation, or during a session of meditative concentration, or a certain state after your death. But in your daily life, you are at a dualistic state. So, when you are practicing the state of oneness, how can you be able to enter into the dualistic state and continue to practice? You have to rely upon the aspirational bodhicitta. Therefore, we have to visualize that because we would like to save all sentient beings, and so we are now entering into the three realms from the Dharma realm. In this way, we can then start off with all of our daily living. So, this is to teach you how to make the transit, that is to say, the areas on the screen with brackets are the visualization practices of initiating the programming in entering into the Dharma realm. And the last visualization belongs to the visualization practice of daily life. This is what we have to do when we make the transit from the oneness state to the dualistic state. So, that is reason why the bodhicitta of aspiration is so important. Hence, one is initiating, while the other one is practicing, and so please do not make a mistake and confuse them. Both initiating and practicing are the things that we need to do at different stages of transit, and the visualization involves the aspirational bodhicitta. Therefore, we have to see it clearly that, in fact, these three stages have such an important link together, as well as areas of differences. Thus, what sutras do we use to illustrate it the best? As you remember, I have used the Heart Sutra to explain the states of waking up from sleep, or emerging from meditation, or during a session of meditative concentration, and the link between them, I have already taught you. You have to visualize that in order to save all sentient beings, and so you have to enter into the three realms from the Dharma realm. Hence, you can step across from the states of waking up from sleep, or emerging from meditation, or during meditative concentration, to the states of daily life or in a dream, and this is how to step across. That is to say, can we clearly look at this chart again? Indeed, I don't draw this chart casually. Referring to the contents of this chart, please do not think that it is easy, so that many people should know how to explain it. But, in fact, even the Dharma King does not know how to explain the absolute bodhicitta, and so he also explains it wrongly. Obviously, the absolute bodhicitta is the perfect enlightenment, but he does not know how to explain it. Therefore, you should know that this chart, in fact, is not that easy to draw. For this chart, I will explain from the first to the fifth steps to you, so that you can use it as a bird's eye view to have a broad overview of the whole picture. Hence, let's now take a look. First of all, we initiate the programming in entering into the Dharma realm, because of compassion, and that is what I have taught you. And because we have compassion, we can integrate with the Bodhicitta of all Buddhas to become oneness. Otherwise, you would not be able to integrate. If you do not have these characteristics, then as those characteristics of both, that is, of all Buddhas and of you, are so much different, and so how can you integrate? Anyway, you should at least possess some characteristics which are similar to the characteristics of all the Buddhas' nature of mind, then you and all the Buddhas can link together, and thus be able to integrate with each other to become oneness. That is, compassion is the key point for you to enter, so that you and the perfect enlightenment of all the Buddhas could integrate with each other to become oneness. And because of your compassion in saving sentient beings, you could then restore your own Bodhicitta, or intrinsic nature, that is the perfect enlightenment. Therefore, this compassion is our activation key at all the states of waking up from sleep, emerging from meditation, or during meditative concentration, and that is a core as well. How about the aspirational Bodhicitta? Since we have to save all sentient beings, so we can enter the three realms from the Dharma realm, and then we can start a new day in our daily life. That is, it belongs to the core of both the aspirational Bodhicitta and action Bodhicitta. That is to say, both the aspirational Bodhicitta and the action Bodhicitta are the activation keys in our daily life or in our dreams. In fact, it is also the core. Then you have to know this chart clearly. What is the aspirational Bodhicitta? That is, you have to make a vow to save all sentient beings, and you must have this. If you do not make a vow, then it is impossible for you to be integrated with the perfect enlightenment of all the Buddhas. That is, you have to stay in the cyclic existence forever, and you would never be able to enter into the Dharma realm to attain Buddhahood, and you would never be able to be liberated from the cyclic existence, therefore, a vow must have to be made. What is the action Bodhicitta? I have already said, you should receive and then hold on to the Dharma of love Bodhisattva precepts. So, some Dharma believers, who would like to take refuge, have asked, can you please do not transmit it to me? Can you not force me to accept the Bodhisattva precepts? But then you still allow me to join the Dzogchen Buddhist Association, International. I said, sorry, no, those people who do not know it, of course, would say yes. But since I know it, it is so sorry to say, no. If you would like to join our Dzogchen Buddhist Association, International, and you also would like me to help you to be liberated from the cycle of karmic existence, and to teach you to succeed in your Dharma practice, then the first thing you have to do is that you have to receive and hold on to all the major precepts, not only the 5 precepts and 10 virtues, but you should also receive and hold on to the Dharma of the Bodhisattva precepts. Otherwise, I will not let you join in our Dzogchen Buddhist Association, International. So, you must receive and hold on to all these precepts. In addition, you have to do all the behavioral actions of benefiting both oneself and others. What is the absolute Bodhicitta? I have already taught you that this has to be in complementary with the
precepts,
meditative concentration and wisdom,
as the precepts,
meditative concentration and wisdom, also belong to something of the dualistic or multiplistic state, and so you must have to make them to be in balance, and thereafter you have to induce them formally in entering into that kind of a balanced state of the
precepts,
meditative concentration and wisdom, such that it would help and assist you to enter into that emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Only in this way can you arouse the perfect enlightenment. Therefore, for the restoration of the absolute Bodhicitta, the only way for you to restore your absolute Bodhicitta is to have emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, which is the activation key and the core of our absolute Bodhicitta. Thus, emptiness is the most important thing of all, but not the so-called the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight. It is, indeed, the emptiness. However, for our practices program, how do you initiate the programming in practicing the absolute Bodhicitta? That is, for the states in falling asleep, or during the meditative state. It is mentioned earlier that the initiation program is the preparation, so what are they? Since this involves some visualizations, so it cannot be disclosed, and hence I cannot talk about it here. Indeed, I have already explained to you up to this very point, but I can only mention its core just to let you know, but no more than this. It is because you have not taken refuge from us, and so we could not teach you this visualization. Well, you have to remember that there are three states, namely, one is initiating, one is practicing, and one is maintaining. These three things are the key points of our Dharma practice, that we need to know and understand them all. So, you must know how to practice all the way from the first step to the fifth step. You should also possess all the elements contained in the first step to the fifth step, and you should practice them all. I have taught you the initiating. Then, what will I teach you next? That is, how to practice, and how to maintain. I will continue to teach you these two things as we go on. Let's take a look, for our daily visualization practice, how we could use one kind of visualization practice to practice all the way from the first step to the fifth step. You have to remember that when we see visualization practice, there, of course, would have an object for the visualization practice. When we say daily life, of course, involves something with form and appearance. Having an appearance is having a form and appearance that you can actually see. If something that has form and appearance, and that is the object that you can visualize, at the same time, this kind of visualization practice will definitely involve practice without form and appearance, and without an object, which is emptiness itself. And that is, emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Hence, for your visualization practice, these are the two things that you must have as objects of visualization. What is meant by object with form and appearance? What would certainly be involved in our daily lives? It involves people. Daily lives also involve events and objects, and daily lives certainly involve emotions. Likewise, daily lives definitely involve thoughts, and daily lives, of course, would involve all kinds of scenes. All these would be included. What is meant by object without form and appearance? Without form and appearance refers to emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Shall we explain it in more details? In fact, whether it is with form and appearance or without form and appearance, you should remember that you have only one goal. This goal is to practice compassion and bodhicitta. So, please don't go to the wrong direction and make it another thing altogether. The goals are simply these two things and nothing more. Perhaps you might say, no, I would like to go to the pure land, and you don't need compassion. But then, if you don't have compassion, you would not be able to go to the pure land. Please do not have the right order to be reversed, since we have to practice the compassion and bodhicitta. That is why we have this object of visualization practice. Therefore, please remember the goal is to have compassion and bodhicitta as the main characters. How about those objects of the visualization practice? They are only ancillary conditions. So, please don't get me wrong and be mistaken that those objects are the main characters. Otherwise, you will certainly not be able to succeed in your Dharma practice. Well, can you explain it in more details? In short, you should remember this one pith, all the visualization practice must be induced into emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Otherwise, all the visualization practices that we are talking about now would become misleading, or even hurting you. Therefore, you should remember that it must be induced into emptiness. Neither existence nor voidness. Then, what do we need to do before inducing it into emptiness? We will have to see or visualize the situation of the sufferings of all sentient beings in our daily lives, and then either in an event or in an object, we will have to see or visualize the situation of a destroyed event or object. Emotionally, you need to be realizing and knowing, and have feelings about it. You will have to feel the types and levels of this emotion, and this is known as realizing and knowing, or intrinsic awareness. And we have to use this kind of realizing and knowing for our Dharma practice. For any particular kind of thought, we will have to use our realizing and knowing to understand the arising of such a thought. For all scenes, we will have to use this kind of realizing and knowing to make use of all scenes as the path of advancement. All these scenes become ancillary conditions in helping me to practice my compassion and bodhicitta. To get the heart essences from all sorts of things, that is, I will have to get a key point, a core and a heart essence from all scenes, as well as from all sorts of things, in order to help and assist me in my Dharma practice. Then, what is the goal? It is to restore our compassion and bodhicitta. Fat is considered S without form and appearance. I have mentioned it before, that is, emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. For all these things, you must remember that the goal is to regard compassion and bodhicitta as the main characters, and the object of visualization practice is just an ancillary condition, playing a supporting role. All of these things will have to be formally induced into emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. If you do not have this item, you cannot induce them into it, and then you can only visualize all these things. In this way, you would be attached to the different forms and appearances, and you then will be constrained, confined and limited, such that you would not be able to restore your perfect enlightenment. Therefore, we must have to use our greatest realizing and knowing, or intrinsic awareness, to realize and know all those objects with forms and appearances that were mentioned before, and then you should induce them into emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. This is a kind of visualization practice that we practice altogether from the first step to the fifth step. However, there are still many details in them, and so I will have to teach you slowly later on. In each of the following sessions, I will teach you how to disassemble it bit by bit, how to gradually and slowly coordinate with this aspect, and then with that aspect, and then later on how to induce it into emptiness. All in all, I will teach you slowly in order to do so. In fact, there are still a lot of key points in it. I am now only giving you a bird's eye view. If you want to achieve all these things, there is an oral pith instruction in the Diamond Sutra, which states that, without attachment, abiding in stillness and suchness. And there is another oral pith instruction, which states that, all conditioned phenomena are like a dream, an illusion, a bubble, a shadow, like dew or a flash of lightning, thus we shall perceive them. So, do I need to explain it all to you? Yes, of course, if I don't explain the entire Diamond Sutra to you, and if I just say one or two sentences, then I think you might still have chances to become deviated. Therefore, I must explain the entire Diamond Sutra to you. Moreover, I have to explain each paragraph with an actual situation, so that I can teach you to such an extent that you can come to understand it. There are subsequent details of the visualization practice, and how do we use it to complement with our Buddhist holy dharma so as to practice altogether from the first step to the fifth step, and how can we solve our daily problems in actual reality. As you all know, in reality, one cannot buy food if one does not have any money, one will die, or in pain, if one doesn't have any money for the right medical treatment, and that's the reality. Then, how to coordinate all these into our Dharma practice, and how to do visualization practice. All these aspects will be covered slowly later on. However, before I teach you how to do this, I must explain the Diamond Sutra for your better understanding. When I talked about the states of waking up from sleep, emerging from meditation, and during a session of meditative concentration, what sutra did I use to explain? It was the Heart Sutra Prajnaparamita. Hardiya Sutra. Do you remember I have explained the entire Heart Sutra to you? I have explained it in such a way that all aspects complement with what was mentioned in the Heart Sutra. And even with the state after death, I have also explained it in a complementary way with what was mentioned in the Heart Sutra. Now I am going to teach you the visualization practice in our daily life and in dreams, then I should explain the Diamond Sutra. Therefore, I will focus on teaching the Diamond Sutra this time. The full name of the Diamond Sutra is called Vajrakadika Prajnaparamita Sutra, or the Diamond of Perfect Wisdom Sutra, also known as the Foshu Onengdu Anjian Gang Banri Bolu Amiju Jing. What is the meaning of Prajna? That is, wisdom. What is Paramita? Paramita means to arrive at the other shore. What is the other shore? The other shore means the Dharma realm. That is the Dharma realm that we enter when we attain Nirvana. The Dharma realm that the Lord Buddha had entered when he attained Nirvana. What is Vajra? Vajra means, nothing can be stronger nor to be indestructible by this diamond. That is, any defilements or obstacles within the three realms can be shattered by it. It is really powerful with nothing that it couldn't be done. Because of that, it can help you to enter into the Dharma realm. Otherwise, how can you enter the Dharma realm, from the three realms, and that's where this sutra is called the Diamond Sutra. In other words, the kind of wisdom which is so powerful that nothing can be strong enough to be indestructible by it, like a diamond. It can help you to get rid of all the defilements and obstacles, so that you can arrive at the other shore, and let you enter into the Dharma realm. Therefore, the whole sutra is the teaching methods with the highest wisdom to help you to enter into the Dharma realm, from the three realms, so it is called the Diamond Sutra. The version that I used was the version translated by the Ven. Tripitaka Master Kumarajiva, 344-413 AD. In fact, it is available in several translated versions. The Diamond Sutra is one part of the 600 volumes of the Mahaprajnaparamita Sutra, that is, the large sutra on the perfection of wisdom. It belongs to the Mahaprajnaparamita Sutra, and is considered as the part which is the essence of this whole sutra of great wisdom. How about the Heart Sutra? The Heart Sutra is the synopsis of the 600 volumes of the Mahaprajnaparamita Sutra. Now that I have finished teaching you the Heart Sutra, I must teach you the highest wisdom, and so I must explain to you the Diamond Sutra. The Diamond Sutra begins like this. Thus I have heard, means, I have heard like this or have heard like this. What does it mean, just as what I have heard? Very often you see Buddhist sutras must begin with this sentence. The word, I, means Akariya Ananda. After the Lord Buddha's Mahaparinirvana, Akariya Ananda and all the disciples, you know that in the past there was no tape recorder, no video camera, no paper and pencil. So, if they want to record down what the Lord Buddha had said, then what could they depend upon? It was purely by memory, depending on memory in the brain, who had the strongest memory. I can tell you that, among all the disciples of the Lord Buddha, Akariya Ananda had the strongest memory of them all. Who was Akariya Ananda? He had served as the Lord Buddha's attendant for 25 years. What was his job? He was the attendant who followed after the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni throughout day and night during all those years. Therefore, he had heard all the sutras that were being taught by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni. Then, you might say that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had taught various sutras for 49 years, and Akariya Ananda had been following him for at least 25 years. So, what does it mean? In fact, it was in the third year that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had started out to propagate the Buddhist holy Dharma that Akariya Ananda had already taken refuge from the Lord Buddha and then followed him. After the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had propagated the Buddhist holy Dharma for over 20 years, he felt that, I must find a regular attendant. For the past 20 years, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni often looked for different attendants. However, those attendants usually had very strong hearts of egocentric pride, or ego attachment and clinging. So, they very often did not listen to the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's swords, such that when the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni asked one to go to the east, he just went to the west, and when the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni asked one to go to the west, he just went to the east. Therefore, in this way, it had caused great disruptions for some of the programs for the propagation of his Buddhist holy Dharma, and had caused great inefficiency in terms of his time management. When the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni was still relatively young, he thought that he could still manage these situations. However, after having changed for many attendants, he felt that he was getting older and older, and by the time he was around 55 years old, he felt that as he was getting older and older, he must search for a regular attendant. This attendant should know and understand everything and would not make any mistakes. It should not be the kind of person that where the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni asked him to go east, he would go to the west. Hence the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni could efficiently use his time to save sentient beings without being wasted. Consequently, he said publicly to all his disciples, "Who is willing to be my regular attendant?" At that time, several disciples immediately recommended themselves, but the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni did not say anything, and even Ananda did not say anything as well. Some people asked, "Why don't you say anything?" Ananda said, "The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni has his own decision. When he has a decision, he'll naturally say it out, so I do not need to say anything." Thus, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni officially announced, "I would like Ananda to be my regular attendant." However, Ananda proposed 8 conditions to the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni. "Of course," he said respectfully, "I would like to ask you if you can promise me on 8 things. Now, I would just mention 2 of the conditions. So, Ananda spoke out one of the conditions as follows: Lord Buddha, can you promise me, if I have any doubts, any problems or anything that I don't understand, then I can ask you, and you will answer me immediately. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni agreed to this. In addition, Ananda said to the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, is it possible that, if you have talked about some Buddhist holy dharma, but I am not around and have missed it, then can you repeat it just to me in private, that is, to repeat once more to me right from the beginning? The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni also agreed to this. Hence, Akariya Ananda had become the regular attendant for the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, until the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had entered into Mahaparinirvana. Hence, the Ananda had been the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's attendant for 25 years. Although Ananda had served as a regular attendant to the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni for 25 years, but I can tell you that anything that was related to the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni's Dharma teachings, he would have heard about it at least once, and he could even recite it. So, later on when all the disciples wanted to assemble all the teachings of the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni and write them down, or required some person to recite other Buddha's teachings out loud, in fact, they all soused reciting, relying upon memory and the brain's eyes to write them out. In this way, they would rely upon Ananda to recite out loud, and then assign different people, each of them use their brains like a tape recorder, to record down all the things that Ananda had said. So, in this way, each person knew how to recite one Buddhist sutra, and then they would put them all together to become the whole collection of the Buddhist canon, and thus we are now able to have all that many Buddhist sutras, and that was how the Buddhist sutras came into existence. Therefore, that was the reason why the words "thus I have heard" appeared in all of the Buddhist sutras. In fact, it is to say that Akariya Ananda heard the Lord Buddha said this in person. So, this "I have thus I have heard" refers to Akariya Ananda himself. Since his memory was very strong, but unfortunately, he had only attained the initial fruit, the stage of Sratapanna, at that time. That is, by the time when the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had entered into Mahaparinirvana, it was not known to us as to whether he had no time to practice, or for some other reasons, but he had some obstacles that made him to have only attained the initial fruit. As you all know, we have to attain the forefala, reaching the fourth stage, in order that we could achieve the arhat. He could only attain the initial fruit. That is the first fruit, which is the most preliminary one. So, in letting Ananda to recite those Buddhist sutras by saying that those were the words that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had said in those days, thus letting him to represent the Lord Buddha to say out the teachings. But you must also know that all the disciples who did the recordings of the teachings had already attained arhats. There were a few hundred disciples, and they were all arhats. With forefala, who were very powerful. They would be doubtful if they listened to the saying of them, initial fruit, the stage of Srotarapana. They would have some doubts about whether Ananda had remembered it wrongly, and was it like this. Hence, the majority was not convinced. Therefore, before the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had entered into Mahaparinirvana, he said to Ananda, you must remember that when you need to assemble and collect the Buddhist sutras in the future, you must at the beginning of each volume, that is at the very start of each sutra, add those four words. Thus I have heard, you must add them. Therefore, in the first volume of the Mahaparinirvana Sutra, it was mentioned that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni taught Ananda like this. He said, you must speak of thus I have heard, that is, you have to talk about those words. You have to remember to say, thus I have heard, meaning that I have listened to what the Lord Buddha had said like this. Once means, at that time. Buddha lived in a certain place, that is, the Lord Buddha had lived in somewhere at that time, in a certain place of a certain country, you must have to speak it all out very clearly. With other people, that is, those who were with the Lord Buddha together. Then this sutra was spoken, that is, therefore the Lord Buddha had talked about this sutra, you should remember all these things and say it all out without missing anything. He said, in this way, you can extinguish all the doubts from all the people. That is to say, there are those witnesses, there are those people who were listening at that time, then there were those who were at the congregation listening to the Lord Buddha's preaching, and what was being said in what particular place. If there are someone who still do not believe in it, they can ask again to see if this is really what was being said. Then, those people will no longer have any doubts upon you anymore. So, you would see that all the Buddhist sutras must start with thus I have heard, once Buddha is in that city, in that place, at the beginning, and it must have those words. and with whom the Lord Buddha had preached this sutra. Therefore, you would definitely see all these information because they were the rules and regulations as put down by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni. Therefore, once, that means, at that time. Then, once, thus I have heard. At that time, the Buddha was staying in the Anathapindadas Park at Jetta Grove in Shravasti. The Buddha was in a place called the Anathapindadas Park at Jetta Grove, with a community of 1,250 bhikṣus. How to explain the word of community? The word of community means of having people gathering together. The world honored one with the elder bhikṣus, that means the elder level of bhikṣus, around 1,250 people gathered together in one place with the Lord Buddha. When means at that time. When it was the meal time for the world honored one, the Lord Buddha was holding his alms bowl and went begging from door to door, that is the time for the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni to do his alms begging. Buddha put on his robe, he took his alms bowl, and he went into the great city of Shravasti. The Lord Buddha went from house to beg for food. This done, he returned to his abiding place, finished the meal, and he put away his robe and bowl. Everything is well prepared. The Buddha washed his feet, arranged his seat, and sat down. So, everybody was sitting down as well. Then, at that time, the elder Subhuti in the assembly, at that time, there was an elder called Subhuti, and he was there. He arose from his seat. He stood up from his seat. He bared his right shoulder. This was a ritual of politeness and greeting. If you want to worship the Lord Buddha, that is, when you ask the Buddha to enlighten you, you have to do this ritual, which was to reveal his right shoulder. Knelt on his right, meaning his right knee was on the ground, which was meant to pay his due respect to the Lord Buddha. With his palms joined and respectfully addressed the Lord Buddha by saying, "How remarkable, a world-honored one." He said, "This is really a superior and rare opportunity, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni. The Tathagata is ever mindful of bodhisattvas. The Tathagata refers to the Lord Buddha, and he was the best at caring for the bodhisattvas, protecting and instructing the bodhisattvas well. The Lord Buddha was also very good at teaching the bodhisattvas, and reminding them of how to do the real practice, which was really a superior and rare opportunity. The A World-Honored One is one of the holy names of the Lord Buddha, Shakyamuni. He said, virtuous men and virtuous women, if there are some sentient beings who are very gracious, with immense wisdom, and if these virtuous men and women resolve to attain the Anuttara Samyaksambodhi, unsurpassed perfect enlightenment. So, what does it mean by the Anuttara Samyaksambodhi? Anuttara, that is, unsurpassed, means there is nothing above it, nothing that is more powerful than it. It is the highest, that is the meaning of the highest. Samyak means well-balanced and equally abiding. Sambodhi means complete and perfect enlightenment, because bodhicitta is the meaning of intrinsic awareness. And so, Sambodhi means complete and perfect enlightenment, that is, there should not have any deviations at all. Thus, the actual meaning of Anuttara Samyaksambodhi literally means the unsurpassed, well-balanced and equally abiding, complete and perfect enlightenment, and its abbreviated form is the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment. Therefore, if you resolve to attain unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, Anuttara Samyaksambodhi, it is the same as that you have made up your mind to restore your unsurpassed perfect enlightenment. Accomplishing the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment means the attainment of Buddhahood, that is, you have made up your mind to become a Buddha and to restore your bodhicitta. So, what is the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment? That is the absolute bodhicitta. Essentially, anyone who speaks of the Buddhist Holy Dharma, anyone who has read about the Buddhist Sutras, or if you want to become a guru so as to propagate the Buddhist Holy Dharma, you must have to know the exact meaning of the absolute bodhicitta, which is a basic knowledge. Why this basic knowledge is called the absolute bodhicitta? In fact, the absolute bodhicitta refers to the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, Anuttara Samyaksambodhi. If you call yourself a Dharma king, but you actually said that the absolute bodhicitta is a kind of meditation that includes the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight, this answer is wrong. This is absolutely wrong. As you have stated that what is considered as the state of oneness has now been considered as in the dualistic state, and so this is totally wrong. There is no way for it to include anything which is dualistic in nature. Therefore, you have to remember this important point. You could take a look at many Buddhist sutras. They all have this term of anuttara samyak sambodhi. I have explained it to you each time quite easily. However, I did not explain it to you with word by word in its meaning. But then why do I have to match each word with its explanation for you this time? It turns out that it will really need to be very strict. In fact, being a guru needs to be very strict in one's attitude. Otherwise, those sentient beings, as well as my future disciples, will not know how to answer those questions posed by others. Like, for instance, when someone asks them what is the absolute bodhicitta, they might think that what the Dharma king said is more impressive than what the Lord Buddha had said as anuttara samyak sambodhi, and so they would probably answer it wrongly by saying that their absolute bodhicitta is a meditation practice which includes the union of shamatha, calm abiding, and vipassana, penetrative insight. Then, they will be in serious troubles, so, I think for a while, I feel that it shouldn't be like that at all. Since I am a guru myself, I have to place myself in the right position of a guru, that is, I have to be very strict. I was not strict enough before, not like what I am doing now to translate every word. Therefore, I am now translating every word for you, as I am afraid that my disciples might not understand the meanings of this sutra, and so they might explain it wrongly in the future, such that it would harm the Buddhist holy Dharma, and that is no good. Hence, I will translate each word to let you know the correct meanings. How should their mind say be day? Let us take a look right now. He said that all those virtuous men and virtuous women resolve to restore their unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, and want to become a Buddha. Then after making up their minds, how should their minds abide? The meaning of abide is to keep and hold, which also means to practice. Then how to keep and hold it, as well as to stay. Abide altim and to stay. Where should one be staying? So, how should one practice? That is, always stay there with no revert, staying without reverting back. That's the meaning of how to practice. How should their thoughts be subdued? Their thoughts means those deluded thoughts. I have just explained it earlier, how to explain those deluded thoughts. They are the unreal and illusory thoughts. It means that other than those things that you are practicing, as now you are practicing the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, those chaotic thoughts that are not related to the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment are called the deluded thoughts. In other words, those things that you are not practicing are the deluded thoughts. Therefore, anything that is not related to the theme of your subject is also called deluding thoughts. Hence, how should their minds abide? How should their thoughts be subdued? This means that how one should abide and subdue one's mind with such large amount of deluded thoughts in order to restore one's unsurpassed perfect enlightenment. So this is the sentence which the elder Subhuti had asked the Lord Buddha. Regarding the meaning of this whole paragraph, that is, in our daily lives, how should we carry out our mind training so as to enable us to achieve our absolute bodhicitta? This absolute bodhicitta is the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, which is the attainment of Buddhahood. That is to say, how we can carry out mind training in our daily lives so as to enable us to attain Buddhahood and to restore our unsurpassed perfect enlightenment. This is the explanation on the meaning of this question. The whole sentence is, in fact, asking this question. Therefore, I said that the Diamond Sutra is to teach you how to practice in your daily life. This is what it means. As it begins like that, then the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni answered like this. The Buddha said, excellent. Excellent. Meaning good question, good question. He said, Subhuti, it is as you have said. The same as what you have said, the Tathagata is ever mindful of the bodhisattvas, protecting them well. The Buddha is very good at caring for the bodhisattvas. And the Tathagata is ever mindful of the bodhisattvas, instructing them well. The Buddha is also very good at teaching and instructing them. Now listen attentively. Now you must listen carefully, and I shall explain it to you. I will definitely explain it to you very clearly. Virtuous men, virtuous women, means that all those virtuous men and virtuous women are so very kind and so wise. Why would he say virtuous men and virtuous women? You have to remember, why did he not just say the virtuous men and delete the virtuous women? You should know there are many Chinese Dharma masters here who have said that women could not become Buddhas, but you still say that a woman can resolve to attain their unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, anuttara samyak sambodhi. So that is really ridiculous, simply because they don't believe that a woman could become a Buddha. They, those Chinese Dharma masters, would scold you right away. Hence, I am now also taking this opportunity to tell you why Buddhism has entered into this so-called Dharma-ending age, because a lot of people have explained the Buddhist Holy Dharma wrongly. Now I'll show you some evidence. It was mentioned in the Diamond Sutra of virtuous men, virtuous women. I explained to you that for the majority of the Buddhist sutras, each and every one of them also states like this, that is, virtuous men, virtuous women. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni was very impartial, he did not discriminate and would not discriminate, so he would certainly not just say, virtuous men. You also know that many bhikshus are Raman. So, merely the mentioning of virtuous men should already be okay, but then why the Lord Buddha also mentioned virtuous women? Indeed, the Lord Buddha was informing you that women can also become Buddhas, don't you understand? If you really do not understand this, that means that your brain has been blocked. Well, let me explain it now. Virtuous men and virtuous women, all those men and women who make such a vow that they resolve to attain the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, anuttara samyak sambodhi. Then, after they have decided to make such vows to restore their unsurpassed perfect enlightenment and absolute bodhicitta, they should abide their minds. Which means that they should stay there. They should subdue their thoughts, that is, they should do this to subdue all of their deluded thoughts. Then, Subhuti said, yes, that is, right, right. World-honored one, that is, yes, yes, world-honored one. We are listening with great anticipation, that means I like it very much, I am very happy, I really want to hear all about this. This sentence is explained like that. After that, the Lord Buddha said to Subhuti, the bodhisattvas and mahasattvas. Mahasattvas means great, so all the bodhisattvas mean all those great bodhisattvas, should thus subdue their thoughts. Who are the great bodhisattvas? For those ordinary, with their first arousal for the determination to restore the unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, there are already known as bodhisattvas. But who are the great bodhisattvas? This refers to those who have practiced in deeper levels, and they are called the great bodhisattvas. Please remember that you should subdue all your deluded thoughts as such. Subdue their thoughts means to subdue all the deluded thoughts. As long as you can subdue all those deluded thoughts in such a way that you are able to practice to the extent that you do not have any of those deluded thoughts, then your absolute bodhicitta and your unsurpassed perfect enlightenment would be naturally revealed by itself. It would manifest automatically. Thus, the Lord Buddha said that you should abide like this, so that your minds will be subdued. Regardless of all the different types of sentient beings, he said this as he would ignore what kinds of sentient beings and from what categories they are coming from. Whether they are born from eggs, from wombs, what does it mean by they are born from eggs? It is similar to those eggs in which sentient beings were hatched from there, such as chickens, ducks, and sparrows. Whether they are born from moisture or from wombs, the meaning of their being born from wombs are like us human beings who are being born after 10 months of pregnancy, and so similarly, for example, sheep, cattle, dogs, etc., are all being born from wombs. If they are born from moisture, correctly speaking, if you follow some modern scientific terms, you may say that these are from some single-cell asexual reproduction, that is, asexual reproduction of single-celled organisms. This is similar to the term of born from moisture, those that are being born from humidity and moisture, and that was what the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni was talking about. Furthermore, what is called transformative birth? It is born of transformative changes, and they are born when they make transformative changes, such as the heavenly beings and the beings of the realm of hells. Or after we die, isn't there a body of the Buddha? At that time, which is a transitional period, when our mind, that is the eighth consciousness, leaves our body and enters into the bardo state, then we would have that body of the bardo in a sudden change, and this also belongs to this kind of transformative birth. Well, what does this all mean? The whole name for the above-mentioned births are known as the four forms of births, that is, four methods of life generation. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said that the meaning of these four kinds of births represent the ways in which all lives are generated. He said, all sentient beings, regardless of what method is being used to generate it, and this is the meaning. Then, what is the meaning of whether they hate form? Form is material, or substance, that is, whether your form of existence belongs to those sentient beings who have material substance or not. Whether they have no form, that is, those sentient beings with no material form of body. Whether they have thoughts, that means perhaps you are those sentient beings with thoughts. Within our three realms, that is, within the desire realm, the form realm and the formless realm. The realm of desire is the realm full of desires where we are now residing, and where we are. The realm of form is where there is still having the existence of material substance, but its density is already very sparse in nature. For the formless realm, it is a realm without the existence of material substance. Within these three realms, only those beings in the Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven, have no thoughts. The Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven, located in the form of realm, is a relatively high level of heaven. It is within the fourth dhyana heavens, so if you can be reborn over there, that means your power of meditation have already reached the level of the four dhyanas. Thus, you often tell yourself, I don't have thoughts, I don't have any thoughts, idn't of anything, the same as the Heart Sutra, which said that there is nothing, and so now I have to even eliminate all of my thoughts, I need to eliminate all my thoughts, and they will be gone. This is identified as the wrong interpretation of the Heart Sutra. If one interprets it wrongly, then one would surely practice it wrongly. In fact, practicing wrongly is a very serious matter. If one is practicing wrongly by really eliminating one's thoughts, then where will one go? One will then go to the Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven. As for those sentient beings, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said, I will save them too, I will rescue those who would eliminate their own thoughts. That is to say, within the three realms, apart from those sentient beings in the Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven, all other sentient beings do have their own thoughts. Thus, what does it mean when the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said, whether for those sentient beings who have thoughts, as well as for those whether they have no thoughts? That is, for those sentient beings who have no thoughts, by referring to those sentient beings who have wrongly interpreted the Heart Sutra, and so they have said that there was nothing at all, and thus they have even eliminated their own thoughts and thus went to the Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven. And the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said that he will save them as well. Whether they have neither thought nor no thought, that is to say, at the highest point, or the peak of the formless realm, there is a heaven known as the Naivasam Nanasam Nayatanad. Those beings over there are neither thinking nor not thinking, or neither conceptualization nor non-conceptualization, so this is known as the Naivasam Nanasam Nayatanad. Or heaven of neither thinking nor not thinking. That is to say, those sentient beings there do not have gross or heavy thoughts, but there are still some very subtle thoughts in their minds, so they seem to be thinking, and yet they seem not to be thinking. Therefore, its name is known as the heaven of neither thinking nor not thinking. Even if those sentient beings go there, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said, I will save them too, I have to save those sentient beings. That is what it means. Well, for all that I have mentioned just above, what is it referring to? It refers to all sentient beings, all sentient beings. Disregard of how your life is generated, no matter what your life is, and what is your state of existence. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni swords mean, I will save you too. He said, I will liberate all of them by leading them to Nirvana without residue, Nirupadesesa Nirvana. The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said, I will bring them into Nirvana without residue. For the word liberate, this word has been translated into Chinese as eliminate. You must remember that I think this word is not translated well enough. Eliminate is often perceived as to simply eliminate it, to perish it with nothing left, and so in this way one will go to the Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven. Without residue means there is nothing left, and so, nirvana without residue is such a nirvana without any remainder, with nothing left behind. But I have said this before that nirvana means that one enters into the Dharma realm. That is the day when the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni became a Buddha. He was a Buddha and had restored his unsurpassed perfect enlightenment, and yet he still had a physical body that remained at that time. Indeed, he was a Nyingmapa Buddha at that time, and so he still had a physical body that was left behind at that time, and so there was something that was left behind. So, actually, nirvana without residue means I am dead now. I will give up this physical body and I don't need it anymore. I will directly guide my own realizing and knowing, intrinsic awareness or rigpa, to enter into the Dharma realm. Thus, by entering into the Dharma realm without leaving anything behind, even without this physical body to be left behind. This is what is meant by nirvana without residue. There is nothing to be left over, there is nothing at all, and then I'll enter into the Dharma realm. That means my own realizing and knowing, intrinsic awareness or rigpa, will be entering into the Dharma realm. The Lord Buddha had said, I will also save all these sentient beings so that they can stop clinging onto those things and to be formally entering into the Dharma realm. In such a way, immeasurable, countless and infinite numbers of sentient beings have all been liberated. He said, if it happens like this, then I would have severed such countless and limitless sentient beings, because what I have said just now included all kinds of sentient beings, regardless of how they were generated, and regardless of how they have existed, I will save them all. And so I would have saved a lot of sentient beings. Yet, in reality, no sentient beings have been liberated. The Lord Buddha said, in fact, no sentient beings have been liberated. Why is that? The explanation seems to be somewhat unclear. It should be explained like this. To enlighten and save all sentient beings by guiding them to enter into the Dharma realm means that all sentient beings who were originally in a dualistic or multiplistic state, I would now guide them and teach them to restore their perfect enlightenment of the state of oneness so that they can enter into the Dharma realm. So you should know that those illusions that appear in the dualistic or multiplistic states are the illusory forms and appearances. Actually, they are also derived from the Dharma nature of the state of oneness, which means that they are derived and projected from there, and they are just illusions. I am only helping you to restore your own state of oneness. So, in fact, there is no such a single one, real, eternal and unchanging sentient being that had ever existed from the very beginning to the very end. Since they really did not exist at all, and so why would I need to liberate them? That is the meaning behind this, that Istose has said that what I am teaching you to practice now is how you can re-enter into that state of oneness. Therefore, you must remember that even if you are as powerful as me, and you have saved all sentient beings, but then you should not always think in your mind that I have severed all sentient beings, I have made all sentient beings to disappear, and there are no sentient beings at all by now. If only you think like this, then that means you have attached to notions, that is, where are you abiding? You are abiding at the dualistic or multiplistic states. Hence, you immediately think that there were sentient beings before, but all sentient beings are liberated and have entered into the Dharma realm, so there is nothing left behind. All these mean that there are existences, destructions, creations, and then enter into nirvana. With this kind of antithesis, there exists a dualistic opposition or dualistic dichotomy. Therefore, he said, how can you enter into the state of oneness? Even if you are as powerful as me, you have really saved all sentient beings to enter into the Dharma realm, and everyone is being enlightened and saved by you to have recovered their perfect enlightenment, but this time only you cannot enter into the Dharma realm. Why? It is because in your mind you think that I have saved a lot of sentient beings, those sentient beings have been liberated by me, and there is nothing left behind, and they have all entered into the Dharma realm. Then, you have this existence of duality. And thus every sentient being have been saved by you and have entered into the Dharma realm, except that you could not enter into it simply because you are still thinking about the things of the dualistic or multiplistic states, and therefore you cannot enter into it. He said that you should know that even though I have enlightened and saved those sentient beings, and he continued to say, in fact, no sentient being is liberated by me, that is, no one is being enlightened and saved or liberated by me. There is no such thing at all. Why is this so? The Lord Buddha asked, why is that so, Subhuti? That is, the Lord Buddha asked the elder Subhuti. Then, the Lord Buddha continued to explain, if bodhisattvas abide in the notion of a self, notion of others, notion of sentient beings, or notion of longevity, they are no bodhisattvas. Indeed, he is explaining the principle. Of course, I have explained these principles to you just now, but then you will find that in many Buddhist sutras there are not as much as what I have said. However, I am afraid that you do not understand the things that the Lord Buddha had said, and so I have explained more. But I have to say so many things in order that you will come to understand what the Lord Buddha would say later, and thus I will have to say some more. In fact, what does the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni see, he said. In fact, you should not have these four notions. Now, I continue to explain this here. You see the sentence on the screen, in reality, no sentient beings have been liberated. I would like to talk more about this sentence. After that, I will explain what the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had said later. No notion of self, no notion of others, no notion of sentient beings, or no notion of longevity. In fact, what are they? Please let me explain a little more for you. What is the state of oneness? Let me give you an example, such as there is some beer, you will see picture of a beer on the screen. There is some beer here, then when you pour out some beer, you will find a lot of beer foam, and this beer foam is actually beer. If you do not touch or stir it, then the beer foam will slowly change back to beer, and there will be no more foam. So, have you eliminated those beer foam? That elimination can include the fact that you use a spoon to scoop out those beer foam. By scooping out the beer foam, then actually you would eliminate those foam, and so there would remain just the beer. If we practice in this way, then it would be impossible for us to practice and attain accomplishment. Why? It is because when you eliminate one thing like this, then it means your Dharma nature, which is originally a state of oneness, but you have make it to derive some illusions of a dualistic or multiplistic state. If you often think about eliminating it, then in your mental consciousness you will always maintain a dualistic or multiplistic state, which is, I want to eliminate those things, which are dualistic or multiplistic in nature, then you would never be able to restore back to the state of oneness. This is the same as you want to eliminate the beer foam, so if you still continue to scoop it out, then you would take away some more beer. Consequently, the beer foam will never merge with the beer and change back to the original beer. As the beer foam has been scooped out by you, just like that you often want to eliminate something of a dualistic or multiplistic state, then eventually you will trap yourself either in the Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven, or in the formless realm, and so you would be trapped by yourself in such a way. Therefore, you must not scoop out the beer foam. If you scoop it out, you will trap yourself in the formless realm, because you have split or separated your own thoughts. That is to say, your mental consciousness is further seriously separated, which is, indeed, a serious matter. Therefore, in our precepts, didn't I say that we should use precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom, to support ourselves and to balance it out in our practice? One of the most important precepts is the first item in the five precepts. It has already said that you are prohibited from killing lives, you cannot kill others, and you cannot commit suicide. Why? It is because when you have to kill something, it is equal to eliminate one thing. Hence, in your mind nature, if there exists a killing thought, that killing thought contains a thought of elimination. So, you feel that if you have to wait for the beer foam to change back to beer, but as you have manipulated it for so long and it is still not changing yet, just as you when have waited for a long time, you gradually feel that practicing slowly is that troublesome, and therefore you no longer wait for it. Then you try to use a spoon to scoop out the foam and try to eliminate those beer foam. As a result, you split it. You split its state of oneness, resulting in the situation to become even more serious. You will then be separated forever, and you will then be trapped forever either in the formless realm or in the Asanjni Sattva, no thought heaven. Therefore, you can never be able to make this beer foam to slowly change back to its original nature. In fact, it would automatically change back to the state of oneness if given the right conditions, that is, to change back to beer. However, it cannot be done by now. Therefore, we use this analogy to explain what is the state of oneness. The phenomena of the dualistic and or multiplistic states are basically the illusions that are projected by your own state of oneness. If you want to destroy them and actively do so, then you will make this whole thing more and more complicated and chaotic. In other words, when we practice, we must have no notions, forms, or appearances. If we do have notions, forms, or appearances and then abide by them, we are thus attached to those notions, forms, or appearances, that is, you have been connected with those notions, forms, or appearances as a result. This would be similar to the analogy of the beer and beer foam. If you want to change this beer foam back to the beer in a quicker way, originally you should not touch it but just let it be a natural spontaneous process, and so you should just ignore it and let it be a natural spontaneous process. Therefore, when we practice our bodhicitta, there is this oral pith instruction known as natural spontaneous process. That is, you must not touch it but simply let it operate naturally and spontaneously, and by operating naturally and spontaneously the beer foam will automatically change back to the beer, that is, to the state of oneness. It is equivalent to the fact that we do not take any action towards the beer, and so we should need to have some meditational power. Therefore, our
precepts,
meditative concentration and wisdom have given us some
precepts
and guidelines such that there are some things that you cannot do. For instance, you should not kill any sentient beings, you should not eliminate those beer foam, you should not stir it with a spoon. You also should not hope that by stirring it would make the beer foam to change back to the beer faster. You should not do all these things. Overall, there are some precepts which would prescribe that some things that you should not do, for example, you should not kill any sentient beings, otherwise, you would be in big trouble, as it is equal to the fact that you would eliminate something, and that would split your mental consciousness. So, you should not take any action towards it, and you have to use your meditational power. In fact, precepts are here to help and protect you. There are some things that you should not do, but there are some things that you must do. Later, I will teach you what you should do. Precepts are further subdivided into those not to do precepts, which means those things that you should not do, as well as those to do precepts, which means those things that you must do. Meditative concentration means that once you stabilize it, you should not take any action towards it and give it a steady state. Consequently, those beer foam will automatically and slowly change back to beer. In other words, those deluded thoughts of your dualistic or multiplistic states will slowly change back to the state of oneness of the perfect enlightenment, automatically. But if you stir it in a desperate manner, it will become even worse. Then, you might ask the following questions. We do not use a spoon to stir it, but we are now living in the three realms and we have karma. Therefore, those karmic creditors will take a spoon to stir up my beer. As they keep on stirring it, then I still cannot restore my own perfect enlightenment. So, what should I do? How should I go on with my practice? And how should I go about to deal with it? Therefore, you must have wisdom. That's the reason why precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom are being used to help you to make a balance. That is, you should have the wisdom to let go and to persuade your karmic creditors to let go as well. Then how to let go? Within the precepts, it teaches you how to confess and repent. However, if you do not confess and repent, then how can you let go? When you confess and repent, not only will it enable you to let go of those things in your mental consciousness, but it can also let those karmic victims, that is, those third parties in the karmic chain who feel very angry, thinking that you have hurt them, know that you have now finally confessed and repented, and so has weakened or even removed their intentions to do those things, like finding a spoon in order to disrupt you, to be constantly chasing after you for the karmic debts, and always making you to become chaotic. Therefore, we have to confess and repent according to the precepts, so that we will obtain our meditational power, because when no one is harassing us, or when we are much less harassed, then we can settle in with our meditative concentration. Next, we have to use some more wisdom. That wisdom will be used as how to make those karmic creditors feel that we have already paid back their debts and hence they would no longer harass me. This requires wisdom. And therefore, precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom can help us to make such a balance. Then you can slowly practice your own bodhicitta. In other words, as long as you do not stir up all your deluded thoughts but to straightly follow the precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom so as to maintain its equilibrium and stable state, then that beer foam will automatically turn back into beer. That is to say, all of your deluded thoughts of the dualistic or multiplistic states will automatically return back to the state of oneness of the perfect enlightenment. And this is what you should do for your practice. Therefore, when you are really being able to save sentient beings, it does not mean that there are many sentient beings that have been saved or liberated by you. It is only that you have been restored to the state of oneness. Then later on, their state of oneness will be integrated with yours in the future. Everyone is the same, all are with the same state of oneness, and so there is no difference among you, me and all sentient beings. Everyone has already been integrated into this oneness, that is, the beer foam has already been integrated with the beer, and there is no difference between the beer foam and the beer itself. This is an explanation. In other words, you should not be attached to all those notions, forms, or appearances. Otherwise, you would not be able to recover your bodhicitta, your perfect enlightenment, and your state of oneness. So, here, if bodhisattvas abide in the notion of a self, notion of others, notion of sentient beings, or notion of longevity, then they are not bodhisattvas. The Lord Buddha here said that if you, no matter what, still attached to those things, then you are not a bodhisattva. What is bodhisattva? Bodhisattva means realizing and knowing, or intrinsic awareness. Bodhisattva is awakening, or realizing and knowing, or intrinsic awareness. Hence, if you don't have this realizing and knowing, or intrinsic awareness, then it means that you cannot be awakening. As you cannot be awakening, you would still continue to be attached to those things. That means that if you cannot be awakening, then you are not a bodhisattva, and it is explained like this. So what is the interpretation of bodhisattva? The whole name comes from the Sanskrit word bodhisattva, with bodhi meaning awakening, and sattva meaning a being, that is, the awakening being. But if you still often beat tack to those notions, forms, or appearances, then it means that you are still not yet awakening. Now I will explain very clearly on what are the notion of a self, notion of others, notion of sentient beings, and notion of longevity. This is very important to your Dharma practice in future, especially in your practice of the daily life. So I have to explain it very slowly. What is the notion a self? The meaning of notion of a self is clinging to the notion of I, my appearance or form, like how I look, am I beautiful or not, those things that I possess, all things that belong to me, and all those things that are pertaining to this selfishness, as well as those self-serving mentality with greed, hatred and ignorance, all the seri considered as the notion of a self. Why do I say like this? Since notion can also be interpreted as thinking, or opinion or view, and so you will see in other translated versions of the Diamond Sutra, that it was not translated as notion of a self, notion of others, but instead it was translated as thinking of a self, thinking of others, thinking of sentient beings, thinking of longevity. Therefore, this notion can also be interpreted as thinking. Then you will find out that in the latter part of the Diamond Sutra, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had said very clearly that these are the view of a self, view of others, view of sentient beings. He directly said it clearly that it can be interpreted as the view. That is to say, if we are always attached to the existence of this view of I, it means that there is no way for me to be integrated with all Buddhas to become oneness, and also I have no way to merge into the Dharma realm to become oneness. So, how can I be restored back to the state of oneness? When there is this existence of the I, there are already 2 points, which means that this is something that belongs to the dualistic or multiplistic state. Thus, in this way, how can we be able to restore back to our state of oneness? Hence, there is no way that we can practice to achieve the perfect enlightenment. Therefore, you would not be able to practice and attain your bodhicitta. And so, the Lord Buddha had said, no notion of a self, that is, you cannot have such thinking on the appearance or form of an I, nor to have a view of an I. This is how it is explained. As for the no notion of others, it means that there is no appearance nor form, nor thinking, nor view of any other human being. For example, a beautiful lady have appeared before me, and when I look at that beautiful lady, I feel that her appearance and form is really that beautiful, and so I started to miss her every day and I think of this beautiful lady every day. I have 10 feel like seeing this beautiful lady even when I am closing my eyes. Therefore, this would draw out a lot of greed, hatred and ignorance from yourself deep down inside. You may feel that it is better for you to pursue her, to marry her, or to gain any benefit from her. These will further induce a large amount of greed, hatred and ignorance, that is, an infinite number of dualistic or multiplistic things and events will be created by your own thinking, then you would never be able to enter into that state of oneness. Therefore, in our notion of others, that is, you must not have any thinking or view in relating to a human, whatever human this is. Well, if I like pets very much, I often remember the appearance of my dog, is this okay? This is known as the notion of sentient beings, which means that you should not have any thinking or view or fear a sentient being's appearance and form. I can give you an example. For instance, this includes the notion of gender. I have a disciple who already had a lot of knowledge on the Buddhist Holy Dharma before he took refuge from me. After having practicing on their exoteric Buddhism, or Sutrayana, for more than 10 years, he took refuge from me. After he had taken refuge from me for many years, almost 10 years, and I had already taught him for that long, but he still cannot get rid of his attachment on this notion of gender. On one occasion, in view of his foundation on exoteric Buddhism, or Sutrayana, was quite good, and so I told him to lead some fellow disciples to learn more about the Dharma. Then, I assigned a post to him and told him to guide them for a discussion on the Buddhist Holy Dharma. He said to all his fellow disciples in public that a woman cannot become a Buddha, only a man can become a Buddha. If he had said something else that was wrong, it would not have been a big problem at all, as it was only a small matter, and then I would just have pulled him aside and told him that, you cannot say that, it is wrong, hoping that this would be able to correct him. However, he was now facing all the male and female disciples, that is all of our disciples, by telling them, a woman cannot become a Buddha. Then, this was, indeed, a serious matter. That means he was talking about a few things, including this, our guru is also a woman, and so she cannot become a Buddha. In fact, it is not because I cannot become a Buddha and so I have to explain this now, please do not get me wrong, I only speak for the genuine Buddhist Holy Dharma. In fact, I, also, do not speak out because of my female disciples. But the fact that if all of my female disciples are attaching and clinging onto this idea that they could not become Buddhas, then it will be in great problem. It is because when their mental consciousness keep thinking about this, I will never be able to become a Buddha. Such a thought belongs to the thought of the dualistic or multiplistic state, such that they would indeed never be able to return to the state of oneness, and thus they would really never be able to become Buddhas. However, did the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni really say so? Of course not. He had said, virtuous men, virtuous women, please remember that. He taught you like this, that is, he taught you that even women could also become Buddhas too. Otherwise, there is no need for him to have said, virtuous women. So, I taught this disciple by explaining the reason to him for quite some time. I said, you must listen to me, this thought of yours is wrong. He said, no, some Buddhist sutras have said like this. Then I said further, some of those Buddhist sutras are wrong, as some of them have already been tampered with by someone. You can only give us some examples from those very few Buddhist sutras, but I can have an infinite number of Buddhist sutras to give you as evidence to show the contrary. That all those Buddhist sutras that had been told by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had mentioned virtuous men, virtuous women, and a lot of other Buddhist sutras had also mentioned the same thing. In addition, there had never been a Buddhist sutra which said that a woman cannot become a Buddha. When and where did you ever see such a Buddhist sutra mentioning that? He said, yes, there are several Buddhist sutras which said so. I replied that those must have been tempered with by some other people. If you do not believe in this, then I can explain it to you. So, that was the reason why we had put up a video entitled, Is There a Woman in the Western Pure Land of Ultimate Bliss, available from there. Dzogchen Buddhist Association, International's YouTube channel. You will notice that I have cited a few Buddhist sutras, the contents of which have been tampered with by some people for no reason. In fact, I have already resolved this issue of whether a woman can become a Buddha or not.
Therefore, I said to this disciple, you should not be strongly attached to the notion of gender. You have to confess and repent in this important matter, and you should do so as quickly as possible. If not, these are heavy sins. Why? Since the Buddhist sutras have already said that, otherwise, you are not a bodhisattva. If you are attached to those notions, such as notion of sentient beings, or notion of others. Actually, there are notion of gender within the notion of others, and thus if you are attached to these notion of others, that is, the notions of men and women, then you are not a bodhisattva. Furthermore, you not only cannot become a Buddha yourself, but in fact, you have even slandered the Lord Buddha. It is because you would thus injure and harm a lot of sentient beings, and you would also tarnish and impair what the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas have said. As what the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had said is the genuine Buddhist holy Dharma, which is the most correct thing without any faults. Now you said that women cannot become Buddhas, which is, in fact, a defamation of the Lord Buddha. I said that if one has committed such a heavy and grave sin, one must have to go to the hell realm, and so you must have to confess and repent your sin as quickly as possible. However, he insisted not to confess and repent, and he even refused to confess and repent his sin at all costs. Then, I said to him that if he does not confess and repent the sin, he will need to face a serious consequence of being put into Brahmadanda, translated as silence cut, which means that one will be prohibited from all conversations and communications within the Sangha community. Simply because I cannot let him stay behind in the Dzogchen Buddhist Association International to continue on with his contaminating and poisoning of all the other Dharma brothers and sisters within the Sangha community, as he keeps on telling others that women cannot become Buddhas. Whether I can become a Buddha or not is not really important, even though I am a woman, but when comparing to the fact that you have distorted the Buddhist holy Dharma, such that you have made it almost impossible for a very large number of sentient beings to become Buddhas, then this would indeed be a very serious problem. Once you have distorted the Buddhist holy Dharma and have slandered the Lord Buddha, then you would put yourself into a great trouble. Unfortunately, he had refused to confess and repent his sin, then I have to put him into Brahmadanda. I said, you are put into Brahmadanda. In Chinese, Brahmadanda is formed by two words meaning silent and expulsion. For silent, it means that all disciples are prohibited from having conversations and communications with him in the future. It is because if he continues to communicate with the other disciples, then those disciples' mental consciousness would be contaminated and polluted by his psychological and spiritual toxins and his toxic speech, such that it would put the whole Sangha community into great jeopardy. As for expulsion, it means that he cannot come back to our Dzogchen Buddhist Association International for good, so as to protect our whole Sangha community. I also said to him, only until you have applied and passed the precept examination by studying the book by H.H. Dzogchen Rinpoche on the perfect conduct, ascertaining the three vows, and that you have also confessed and repented the grave sin and obstacle in regards to your great attachment to the notion of gender, then you can come back. Then why one has to confess and repent one's sin? I have just said earlier that if we want to restore back our perfect enlightenment of the state of oneness from the dualistic or multiplistic state, we must have to let go a lot of things, including all things that we have done wrong, and all those matters in relations to the violation of the precepts, and so we have to confess and repent all them. By relying upon the confession and repentance of all our sins and of the transgressions of precepts and samayas, we could then let go all of these heavy burdens. However, if you do not let go all of these, because all these things always belong to the dualistic and or multiplistic states, then you would never ever be able to attain Buddhahood. Therefore, Buddhism always teaches you to let go of all things. The best way to let go is that if you have done something wrong, you must have to confess and repent. You must let go of them through confession and repentance. So, in order to save this disciple, I both pacified and forced him with the hope that he would come to confess and repent, but he did not listen to me. After all, indeed, quite a large number of disciples that have been put in Brahmadanda in our Dzogchen Buddhist Association International were those who refused to confess and repent their committed sins and transgressions of precepts and samayas. But why I have to insist so much on this? I said, if you do not confess and repent, I will not let you come back to the Dzogchen Buddhist Association International. I want them to be wide awake as to what they have done in the past, as well as what they really want to do in the future. Because I want to save them, so I put them into Brahmadanda. Otherwise, why would I have to put them into Brahmadanda for no reason? Of course, I also want to save the other disciples within the Sangha community, as well as the whole Buddhist holy Dharma. In the future, we don't want to find out that there would be such a person who would have represented both of us by saying, women cannot become Buddhas. This would be totally wrong in misinterpreting the Buddhist holy Dharma. It will be extremely terrible, as this will endanger and harm many, many sentient beings. Therefore, I have to force him to confess and repent his sin before he could come back. However, he simply ignored me and refused to confess and repent. He insisted that the Buddhist sutras have said so. He asked me why didn't I ask him to rely upon those Buddhist sutras. In fact, he did not rely upon most of the other Buddhist sutras, but then he only relied upon those very few sutras, that is, those Buddhist sutras that had been tempered by others. Then he asked, what else should he rely upon? He said, there are many Dharma masters who have also said the same thing, and not just him. Then, I want to tell you him that if there are so many Dharma masters who have said this, so does it mean that he was telling me that many Dharma masters nowadays do not really understand the genuine Buddhist holy Dharma, and that they have wrongly misinterpreted the Buddhist holy Dharma? I pray that it is better not to be the case. How can we ever say that a woman cannot become a Buddha? If that is the case, then whether this paragraph of the Diamond Sutra only aims for the men, or whether it also aims for the women as well. Why did the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni have to say, virtuous men, virtuous women, but why not just deleting those two words of virtuous women to make it clear and simple, if that was really what he meant as according to those Dharma masters? Besides, the Lord Buddha also told you that you cannot abide in notion of a self and notion of others. That is, you must not be attached to the notion of gender, otherwise you cannot become a Buddha. Why do these people cannot become Buddhas? It is because their attachments to the notion of gender is equivalent to their attachments to the notion of others. So, I have to tell you that please try your very best not to defame the Lord Buddha in his Buddhist Holy Dharma anymore. It is not an issue on whether I can become a Buddha or not, neither is this an issue that I am a woman, but it is purely an issue of compassion. In fact, I am very compassionate in taking into account of my disciple's commitment of this grave sin and his transgression of precepts. As he has committed this heavy sin and transgressed the precepts, I hope that he could confess and repent as soon as possible so that he could escape the chances of never being able to become a Buddha, nor would he be fallen into the hell realm and suffer forever. I also want to let all women know of this so that they would not be misled by those people and thus cannot become Buddhas. This is the main reason why I want to strongly clarify on this issue. So, in fact, attachments to all these notions, appearances or forms will lead you to have discriminating minds and attached minds. Hence, the notion of sentient beings have been explained such that any of the notions, appearances or forms, including those of all of your pets, you cannot be attached to them. Then, how to explain the notion of longevity? The notion of longevity means that many people would like to live longer and never die, and so they hope to be reborn in the pure land of the Buddha, or to go to the paradise where there is one called the heaven of eternal life, so that they can extend their lifespans over there. I can tell you that there is no such a notion of longevity. Please do not think about it, as this does not really exist. In the Buddhist sutras, it says, impermanence, everything within the three realms is impermanent and cannot be eternal, including the Buddha of longevity that you believe in. Actually, the Buddha of longevity is very long-lived, but it was mentioned in the Buddhist sutras that the Buddha of longevity has a lifespan of many, many tens of thousands of years old. Although they have many, many tens of thousands of years old, but eventually there is an end to it. In other words, it is impermanent. Then, how about those yidam that we visualize? You often tell us that Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, is required to visualize the pure land of the Buddha, to visualize the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara, or to visualize yourself to be the yidam, such that I am the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara, or to visualize that I am the Buddha Amitabha. In this way, I would be able to go to the pure land of the Buddha. So are these all be considered as attachments? Yes, then what do all these attach to? These are the attachments and the notion of longevity. That is so say, if I could be the Bodhisattva Avalokitesvara, I would then last forever and my life would never end. In fact, you cannot attach to such notions, appearances, or forms. Thus, this notion of longevity means that those notions, appearances, or forms that would extend your lifespan. Even though you can say that all Buddhas and Bodhisattvas can live very long, but you must not be attached to this because if so you would have attached to something that belongs to the dualistic or multiplistic state. Then, you will ask, so is it not alright for Vajrayana or esoteric Buddhism to practice like this? I can explain to you that one should not be attached to any kind of things or thoughts, such as the Chan, Zen, school to Buddhism often asks you to investigate on a meditational topic. Actually, this matter of investigating a meditational topic is itself a thought, which is one kind of thinking. Therefore, if you ask someone to keep on investigating on a meditational topic, it is equivalent to keep on abiding on that notion, appearance or form, or being attached to that notion, appearance or form, as well as that thought. So, one would keep on thinking as how to explain this. What is the final result of this thought? What is it? What is the end of it? So, one would think it over and over again, or maybe among the 100 million people, finally there may be one person who would be able to figure it out. However, except this very person, I can tell you that the majority of people, with some being end up having knots in their thinking, and some become even insane after they have thought too much. Therefore, you can find some cases in history that some people have practiced investigating on a meditational topic of the Chan school and have become insane. That is the situation in which they have misunderstood some things, but in fact they should not have done so. Therefore, some people say that the Chan school is a kind of separate transmission outside of the teachings. It was not taught by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni, and so it did not belong to Buddhism. What they taught referred to a different kind of explanation outside that of Buddhism, and thus it has been called as the separate transmission outside of the teachings. In fact, from all of the Buddhist sutras, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had neither taught you the about the investigating on a meditational topic, nor did he ever teach you to be attached to those thoughts. Therefore, as according to those four notions, namely, no notion of a self, no notion of others, no notion of sentient beings, or no notion of longevity, actually, what they are really up to, it is talking about that all notions, appearances or forms, or thoughts, or views, all these things are a kind of deluded thoughts, you should not be attached to any of them. If that thought of yours is not helping it to lead to the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, then it will go to the wrong way, and thus it is incorrect. Actually, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had never taught us such things. Then, how about the Vajrayana practice? Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, also teaches us to visualize on the yidam, so is it correct? That is another matter altogether. Are there any Buddhist sutras that had explained and taught this before? Yes, there are. I shall give you an example, which is recorded in the latter part of the Mahayana Sutra of Mind Ground Contemplation. In this sutra, there is a part in which the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni taught sentient beings to visualize something in their hearts, but what to visualize? It is to visualize on the Vajra. Why the Vajra is being visualized, of course, it has many different purposes, but there are things that I will not be able to explain them in details right now and right here. Actually, its purpose is to make you concentrate on your own thought at one place. And that place can help you to be connected to a pure magnetic field. In this way, your practice will be easier to succeed in entering into the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, through this pure magnetic field. Didn't I just explain to you that the precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom, can help to support you in making a balance? That is the kind of product from there. Precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom. Precepts means that you should stop all those deluded thoughts which are not related to this particular visualization. With regards to the visualization of the Vajra that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had taught in the Buddhist sutras, there are still a lot of other things which I will not explain them in details here. Indeed, you should stop all those deluded thoughts that are not related to the visualization of the Vajra that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had taught in the Buddhist sutras. And this is one kind of precepts. Also, precepts can help you to stop all those greed, hatred and ignorance. There are the 5 precepts and the 10 virtues. The 5 precepts and the 10 virtues can help to extinguish almost all of your greed, hatred and ignorance. Next, you have to do the part on stoppage when you can do this stoppage, that is your precepts that can help you to achieve a meditational power so as to enable you to stop all those greed, hatred and ignorance. By relying upon the precepts, you can then confess and repent your sins and transgressions, so that you can start to let go of all things that were violating the precepts. Once you have done so, your meditational power will appear and your mind begins to settle down. Then, you use your meditative state as much as possible to maintain this state of visualization. Then, you can start to use your wisdom. So, what is this? One of the wisdoms is to visualize on the Vajra in your heart. Of course, there are other things that need to be visualized, including things that I have already mentioned. In this way, it can help you to enter into a very good magnetic field, and to be connected to this magnetic field. You say that there are still 2 points, isn't this the dualistic or multiplistic state? Hence for the next step, as you are under such a good magnetic field, and so when you try to enter into the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, it would be much easier for you to enter into it. So, this method that I taught you, or the visualization method that Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, teaches you, or those methods that the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had taught you in the other Buddhist sutras, in fact, when talking about your next step, it does not contradict with this, the former step. Actually, the former step is to let you use the wisdom of this precepts, meditative concentration and wisdom to help you to transit, to guide and to induce you in entering into the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Hence, in the end, you still have to enter into the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness in order to restore your bodhicitta and perfect enlightenment. Therefore, this has pointed out one thing that Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, was indeed taught by the Buddha, but in the Chan school was not taught by the Lord Buddha. And that the Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, teachings as taught by the Lord Buddha have many Buddhist sutras as proof of evidence, and that it has its own purpose. But in the end, you still have to let go of the 4 notions, that is, you cannot be attached to the notion of longevity by visualizing yourself as a yidam, or in visualizing the Vajra to appear. In the end, you still have to induce all of them into the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness, that is under the best magnetic field so as to induce all of them into the state of emptiness, neither existence nor voidness. Therefore, you must have to understand that Vajrayana, or esoteric Buddhism, teachings were taught by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni himself. It was indeed taught by the Lord Buddha. It has its own principle, and that is the profound principle that can help you the most. Well, what did you have to say about the Pure Land School that ask people to recite on the Namo Buddha Amitabha? In reciting on the Namo Buddha Amitabha, which was taught by the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni in three Buddhist sutras, he was speaking about it to the Queen. The Queen said, "I do not know anything, I do not know how to visualize, I do not know what are the four notions. I also do not know far to those states. I know nothing. However, I am very scared of what should I do after I die." Therefore, the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni said, "In this case, you go to find Buddha Amitabha to save you." So, how can you be able to find Buddha Amitabha? Of course, you have to call the holy name of Buddha Amitabha. Calling him is the same as calling for help to save you. Then, there needs to be a protagonist if you call for help. Otherwise, who would come to save you if you just call for help? So, what do you need to call for? You have to call for the Buddha Amitabha. Now you would like the Buddha Amitabha to come and save you, then you will have to call the holy name of Buddha Amitabha. But is it all right for just calling the holy name of Buddha Amitabha? The Lord Buddha Shakyamuni was also very honest about this. He told you that you have to be without any disturbance of thoughts and one's mind without inversion, that is, you must have a very high level of meditational power. Then you need to wait for either one day or up to 7 days, and so your meditational power must have to be maintained for 7 days. You have to maintain your meditational power from the first day to the seventh day. If you cannot do it, that means you cannot succeed in doing so. Then, would you say that I am too much attached if I am calling the holy name of Namo Buddha Amitabha? Yes, therefore, at the maximum level, you could only be connected to and be linked up with the Buddha Amitabha, who would then save you and take you over to the Buddha's Pure Land. However, all things are impermanent, and I have already told you before that even the Buddha's Pure Lands will also be destroyed one day. Only the Dharma realm could be permanent, for all those things that are impermanent, such as all the things within the three realms, are all impermanent, including the Buddha's Pure Lands, and so they will also be destroyed one day. So, all in all, what must we have to practice? That was why the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had taught you the Diamond Sutra, which is of the highest level and will be the best way for you to be restored to the state of oneness and can thus enter into the Dharma realm to become a Buddha. It is, indeed, the best method. Therefore, the method of the Pure Land School is mainly catered for those who do not understand anything, or for who have not been educated before. Hoping that although they do not understand anything, it is better to provide some kind of a method for salvation to help them rather than not doing anything, or that it is also better than their having nothing to do. It's good for them to call for help and it's good to call the holy name of the Buddha Amitabha, so that at least they can have a chance to accumulate a little merit, or there are some good conditions that can help them abut, so that they do not have to suffer that much. As we are very painful and miserable within the three realms, and so it is good that at least they can suffer less. Hence the teaching of the Pure Land School to Buddhism is merely an expedient teaching method, and it's not the truly ultimate and thorough teaching of the Buddhist Holy Dharma. That is, if you want to talk about on which level are we talking about now. The answer is that the Diamond Sutra is the highest level, which is really a most thorough Dharma teaching that can ultimately help you. Then, Vajrayana also has the highest teachings, and that is the Great Perfection. What has been taught in the Great Perfection is exactly what the Diamond Sutra is talking about. That is, how to enter into the state of oneness of the Dharma realm are taught by it, and that is indeed to be called as the highest level. So, now let us take a look at the four notions that I have just explained, that is, the notion of a self, notion of others, notion of sentient beings and notion of longevity. These represent a general category, namely, all kinds of notions, appearances or forms. It is also having the meaning of all thoughts and all opinions or views. All of the C we considered as deluded thoughts. Hence, what do all these four notions represent? They represent all kinds of deluded thoughts, including the visualizations of the Yidam and the Pure Land as well. Next, the Diamond Sutra mentioned about subdue their thoughts, that is to subdue the deluded thoughts. So what does it mean? It means that you cannot be attached to any notions, appearances or forms. That is, it means that within your realizing and knowing or intrinsic awareness, you have to realize and know that all the deluded thoughts are temporary displays of the Dharma nature, which are akind of projections of illusions from the Dharma nature, all of which do not have any unchanging and eternal notion, appearance or form. It has only one point, and there is no two points or more. You must never try to get connected to those deluded thoughts again. When you connect all those points together, it will become akind of limitation. Hence, if you would like to be all-pervasive without any limitations, then you must need to have only one point. All-pervasiveness has only one point, and there is only one point. So, all of them are having only one point, but they would not be linked up together. As long as they are linked up together, there would be limitations. Therefore, you should remember this important point. This paragraph in the Diamond Sutra is explained in this way. So, if you are not fully awakened to the fact that all deluding thoughts are illusions, it would mean that you would never be able to enter into the state of oneness of the Dharma realm to attain Buddhahood. This would also mean that you would forever be trapped inside the state of duality of the three realms and would suffer from the pains of the cycle of karmic existence. It will be very miserable to be trapped by all those various painful illusions. If we are able to be fully awakened to the fact that all deluding thoughts are illusions, then it would mean that your bodhicitta or perfect enlightenment would be able to manifest, which would further mean that you would be able to enter into the state of oneness of the Dharma realm to become a Buddha, which would also mean that you would be liberated from the cyclic of karmic existence forever. I have just explained to you an example from the sutra called the Mahayana Sutra of Mind Ground Contemplation, which also teaches how to visualize on various things. Indeed, the Mahayana Sutra of Mind Ground Contemplation has taught you to visualize the Vajra in your heart. As I have said earlier, this is just a transitional situation. If you really want to enter into that state of oneness, there is a teaching in the Great Perfection of Vajrayana. So now I have to repeat this point once again just to remind you of the importance. Our treasury of Dharma data is an essence of the oral pith instructions for our practice on the Great Perfection, and it teaches us how to transit from the state of visualized things into the state of emptiness. This treasury of Dharma data was written by Kunkyin Longchen Rabjam, one of the great lineage masters of the Red Sect, Nyingma school, who specialized in the practice of the Great Perfection. These are the collection of the oral pith instructions from the 17 Dzogchen Tantras, which are the oral pith instructions of 17 uncommon, in which uncommon refers to their uniqueness of the Nyingmapa kinds of actual practice methods. It is an aspect of the Great Perfection, which describes the firm approach in cutting through the solidity of elusive reality to the true existence, known as Trekcho in Tibetan. This firm approach in cutting through is to cut through all those attachments. The true existence is to reveal our true nature, which is our bodhicitta. We now take a look at how the Heart Sutra teaches us to visualize. The Heart Sutra teaches us that one should visualize the nature of the five aggregates as emptiness. Actually, we have said this before, so what are the five aggregates? The form aggregate, Rupa Skanda, that is, the substance. The sensation aggregate, Vedana Skanda, is all our feelings. The perception aggregate, Sanna Skanda, is all our ideas and thoughts. The mental formation aggregate, Samskara Skanda, is all our actions, and the consciousness aggregate, Vijnana Skanda, is the store up of our consciousness and mental consciousness. So, what are we going to visualize them as? Actually, their nature is emptiness, that is, originally they belong to oneness, and they are some things that derived from the oneness. They are derived from the Dharma nature of its state of oneness. We have to visualize their essential nature as emptiness, they are oneness. And we have to visualize them as oneness. When we combine them into one, then we could be able to enter into the Dharma realm. What does the Diamond Sutra have to say about this? The Diamond Sutra says that there is, without any notion. I have already said earlier that you must not keep holding onto and attaching to all kinds of notions, that is, the four notions which represent all the deluded thoughts. You must not be attached to all of these, and you should not keep on abiding. Why the term of notions was used? Why did the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni use this term of notions to express such attaching? Why the use of notions? Why the use of appearance, or form, or thoughts, or views to express such attaching? It is because, for so many times, the most direct way for us to see is such a notion, appearance or form. For instance, there is a very beautiful woman, then you will think of something more, such as you think that this woman is so beautiful, I will pursue her in the future and will marry her as my wife. Because of that, a lot of greed, hatred and ignorance would appear, and thus such kind of a notion, appearance or form is our original source. Frequently, the most direct way for us to see is the notion, appearance or form. By then, a lot of greed, hatred and ignorance would be involved from that scene. With that, it will cause us to have many kinds of things from the dualistic or multiplistic states to appear, and then trap us into this cycle of karmic existence. If we want to restore back to the state of oneness, is it necessary to find a solution at the original source? When starting at that original source, we should ignore the notion, appearance or form once we see it, and let it be spontaneously and naturally present, and do not be attached to it. Hence, it will not further implicate on other things. Therefore, the Diamond Sutra says, without any notion, and it means to teach you how to visualize like this, and that is the explanation. It teaches us how to practice in our daily life. It is because in our daily life, what we often see is notion, appearance or form, and it causes us to have a lot of thoughts, and it also leads us to have a lot of views. Hence, it teaches us how to practice. Whereas in the Heart Sutra, it explains the state of the Dharma realm, which belongs to the state of oneness. Therefore, there is nothing in there, and many things are not there, but only the realizing and knowing, or intrinsic awareness, remains there. Nonetheless, how to enter into the Dharma realm? That is what the Diamond Sutra teaches us, that is, with no attachment to any notions. As long as you do not attach to any notions, appearances or forms, then you could be able to enter into the Dharma realm. Yet, the Treasury of Dharmadhatu have mentioned it in more depth. It mentioned that you should visualize or bodhicitta as the intrinsic awareness of the oneness. That means you have to visualize all things as the intrinsic awareness of the perfect enlightenment of the state of oneness, so as to realize and know, in other words, to be aware of everything. That means not to be attached to all notions, appearances or forms, since all notions, appearances or forms belong to those things of the dualistic or multiplistic states. So, this sentence represents that you need not and should not be attached to any notions, appearances or forms, or any thoughts, or any views. This sentence in the Treasury of Dharmadhatu represents what the Diamond Sutra has said about no attachments to any notions, appearances or forms. You should visualize that the bodhicitta is all-pervasive throughout everywhere, and this was something that were not mentioned in both the Heart Sutra and the Diamond Sutra. However, it was mentioned in the Treasury of Dharmadhatu that in the Dharma realm, our Dharma nature is all-pervasive throughout everywhere. Then, we must visualize our Dharma nature is to be all-pervasive throughout everywhere. Besides, the third point is that you should visualize bodhicitta is spontaneously and naturally present without any attachments. The words, without attachment, are also mentioned in the Heart Sutra and the Diamond Sutra. Actually, you should not grasp onto all those notions, appearances or forms. However, it did not say that spontaneously and naturally present. These words of spontaneous and naturally present that I have mentioned before is an oral pith instruction. It is just like the metaphor of having some beer, and that if you do not stir it and let it be still, then the beer foam will naturally change back to the beer. Those are your deluded thoughts, and if you can let them exist naturally and do not stir them, then those deluded thoughts will slowly extinguish and disappear altogether, and return to the realizing and knowing or intrinsic awareness of the perfect enlightenment. Hence, there would not be any kind of connections. However, if you stir it, it means that you are making the connections. On the other hand, if you do not stir it, let it be spontaneously and naturally present, then the perfect enlightenment would reappear in the end. So, that is the explanation of the oral pith instruction. In fact, the Treasury of Dharmadhatu is the visualization practice on a state of oneness. If you compare it with the Heart Sutra and the Diamond Sutra, you will find that it has a few more things which can help you to do the visualization practices such that it would enable you to be able to enter into the state that the Heart Sutra has mentioned. And it will also make it easier for you to master on how to practice the method on no attachment to any notions that was being said by the Diamond Sutra. However, as concerning the state of the bliss and emptiness of the Dharma body, the state of the luminosity and emptiness of the enjoyment body, and the state of the illusion and emptiness of the emanation body, both the Heart Sutra and the Diamond Sutra did not mention about them. However, the Treasury of Dharmadhatu do mention about these aspects, and so this will indeed give more clarity in helping us to practice. In referring to the not-to-do precepts in the Heart Sutra, I have already said that the not-to-do precepts means all those things that you should not do, and so you should not be attached to any notion, to form or appearance of existence. The to-do precepts means upholding those things that you must do, and so you must visualize the nature of the five aggregates as emptiness, and that all dharmas are in the form of emptiness, and these are their characteristics. As concerning neither creation nor destruction, neither impure nor pure and neither addition nor reduction, you also have to visualize their characteristics. Then, what is the not-to-do precepts for the Diamond Sutra? What things that you must not do? I have just said that the thing you should not do is that you should not be attached to any notion, to form or appearance of existence. So, you must not be attached to all notions, to forms or appearances. But then what is the to-do precepts? I have not taught them yet, because in explaining the Diamond Sutra, I have just explained the first two paragraphs, while the latter part has not been talked about yet. When I have finished them, I will then tell you what you must do according to the Diamond Sutra. And what is the not-to-do precepts of the Treasury of Dharmadhatu? In fact, they are the same. You cannot grasp onto anything with the notion of existence. As to the to-do precepts, they are the same as what I have just said, and so you have to visualize them, and so these are their comparisons. Then, I am now going to talk about this section on the discussion of the non-dual bodhicitta of the Treasury of Dharmadhatu, in which there is an excerpt of an oral pith instruction. That oral pith instruction said that our bodhicitta belongs to the state of oneness. The perfect enlightenment also belongs to the state of oneness. That was the reason why I said that what that Dharma king had said was wrong. It is because he did not understand the great perfection. Even though he might have read some of it before, but he was no able to explain it. He could not explain it because he could not integrate the different things, and that was why he did not understand the great perfection. Hence, he would have wrongly regarded the Rinyon of Shamatha, calm abiding, and Vipassana, penetrative insight, as the absolute Bodhicitta. However, the treasury of Dharmadhatu has already explained it very clearly that Bodhicitta is a state of oneness. Now, let us see how it explains it. What is the interpretation of all things are coming from the oneness realm, which is the natural, primordial wisdom. The meaning of everything and every realm is actually the state of oneness of the Dharma realm, which represents everything. In fact, all things are actually derived from the state of oneness of the Dharma realm. So, what really represents everything is not the three realms, but it is the Dharma realm itself. All the three realms are evolved and derived from the Dharma realm, and were then projected out as such. Hence, the meaning of everything and every realm is explained in such a way. Nature means naturally exist, that there is nothing to produce it, and there is nothing to destroy it. It is the very nature and it just naturally exists. How to explain the primordial wisdom? The primordial wisdom refers to realizing and knowing, in other words, intrinsic awareness tib. Rigpa of the perfect enlightenment. When it says that realizing and knowing are perfect enlightenment, naturally exists within everything and every realm, what does it mean? The principle of existence of nature is non-duality. How to explain this? Nature is non-duality. That is to say, the nature of realizing and knowing or perfect enlightenment is the state of oneness. Non-duality means oneness, and there is nothing of two or above which is simply one, that is the state of oneness. In other words, such kind of nature, this very nature of this realizing and knowing or intrinsic awareness of the perfect enlightenment is the state of oneness. This sentence tells you that the perfect enlightenment is such a state of oneness. Hence, the principle of existence is the law of the existence of the state of oneness, which is explained in such a way. The principle of existence of perfect enlightenment is oneness. This is its principle. Dualistic manifestations from the indestructible power manifested in the form of an elusive game. What is the meaning of dualistic manifestations? That is the appearances of the states of dualism and or multiplism, which can be manifestations of notions, or forms, or appearances, and this called the dualistic manifestations. You can see my words highlighted in yellow, which shows the meaning of dualistic manifestations. That is to say, any of those notions, or forms, or appearances being manifested can be seen by you as actually something of the dualistic or multiplistic states. It comes from the indestructible power manifested in the form of an elusive game. Indestructible means neither creation nor destruction. This power of the Dharma nature, intrinsic nature, is neither creation nor destruction in nature, and can manifest itself in the form of an elusive game. That is the explanation of dualistic manifestations from the indestructible power manifested in the form of an elusive game. What does this really mean? This means that it does not really exist, and is like the foam of the beer, which is short-lived, and will be changed back to the beer after being rested for a while. Its existence is not eternal and unchanging, and neither does it really exist. You do not need to attach to it, and you do not need to stir it. The manifestations and expressions of non-duality are known as bodhicitta. What does it mean of the manifestations and expressions? That is, all those kinds of notions, appearances and forms that are being expressed and manifested are known as manifestations and expressions. Non-duality, that is, all are non-dualistic, and they are of oneness in nature. All those notions, appearances and forms are to be seen as oneness. This further illustrates the four notions, as mentioned in the Diamond Sutra. The four notions are notion of a self, notion of others, notion of sentient beings, or notion of longevity. All these represent all kinds of deluded thoughts and all kinds of notions, appearances and forms. The treasury of Dharmadhatu, of the great perfection, which is of the highest category of Dharma practice within Tibetan Buddhism, explained this very clearly, and it echoes exactly with the Diamond Sutra by referring to the same thing, that all those manifested and expressed notions, appearances and forms are actually all having the same nature of the state of oneness. So, I have explained to you just now the reason why the Lord Buddha Shakyamuni had said, I have saved a lot of sentient beings, but in fact I have not saved any sentient beings. I have not really saved any sentient beings. That is to say, what is this called? It is called the bodhicitta. It says that all those manifested and expressed notions, appearances or forms have to be realized and known, in other words, to be aware by you that they are all of the nature of oneness. This kind of intrinsic awareness, or rigpa in Tibetan, is known as bodhicitta, and as perfect enlightenment. You are actually realizing and knowing all of them as such. All these notions, appearances and forms are of oneness, and that they are all manifested and expressed from the Dharma nature. Hence, if you have this kind of realizing and knowing of intrinsic awareness or rigpa, then it means you could now restore your perfect enlightenment, and you could now restore your bodhicitta. So, what is the not to do precepts? In the whole oral pith instruction, what are the things that you cannot do? That is, you cannot be attached to any notion, to form or appearance of existence, which is the same as what Diamond Sutra had mentioned. Of course, they are the same. Then, what is the to-do precepts? What things you should do? You have to realize and know that all these notions, forms or appearances are all having the same nature of the state of oneness. These are what you have to do. This is what you have to do within the whole oral pith instructions. Then, it clearly stated that the bodhicitta is a state of oneness. This is very important and so you have to remember this. Otherwise, you would say the wrong things similar to that of the Dharma King. You have to remember that all these things are oral pith instructions for our visualization practice on bodhicitta. You must remember it. The Diamond Sutra have said this, and this great perfection's treasury of Dharmadhatu have also talked about this as well. You have to remember one thing, that the Avatamsaka Sutra have said that all three aspects of the mind Buddha and sentient beings are of no difference. Actually, we have already said that before, that is, we should integrate them all to become oneness. Otherwise, you would be staying in the states of three realms which are of the dualistic or multiplistic states. You will still have a subject that is able to do things, and the object that is what is being done, such that this would be dualistic in nature, and then you will be staying in the state of duality. Therefore, we have to remember, even when you visualize emptiness, you should not treat emptiness as a notion to form or appearance to visualize. If we visualize a notion to form or appearance of emptiness, then we would be attached to the notion for more appearance of emptiness, but we should not visualize in this way. So, what should we do for the visualization? I will teach you later. In fact, spontaneously and naturally present is indeed the oral pith instruction on this visualization. So, actually, I have already taught you, but you may not understand it, and so I will explain it in more details in the future. Therefore, you have to remember, during the visualization, you must only visualize the characteristics of emptiness, which is the real emptiness. You must not visualize on the notion to form or appearance of emptiness. The notion to form or appearance of emptiness belongs to the category of the four notions, as well as that of all notions, forms or appearance, and all deluded thoughts. Hence, you should remember this very carefully. Thirdly, you must use intrinsic awareness or rigpa and mind nature as the core of your Dharma practice, so that you can succeed in your practice. Fourthly, do not forget what is the visualization method of initiating the programming in entering into the Dharma realm. These are all the oral pith instructions. I will repeat them again and again in every other session, and let you try to understand more. And this is the explanation for today's session. Thank you.